All right, so I will call the September 6th meeting of the school committee to order at 7:32. We're actually going to jump real quickly to number 7, the Eagle Scout presentation. Come on up.
We can start Judy's here.
That's perfect.
Right on this.
Yeah,
that's perfect.
I'm Hunter Figueredo. I'm going to my Eagle Scout, and to get that, I have to do a project. So I'm going to restore the baseball fields here at North Pembroke.
Sure. We can take it. Thank you very much. So Hunter, why don't you tell us a little bit about your project and how you plan on fundraising and all the important things.
Fundraising, I was going to do a scrap metal drive.
Okay.
And some of the restaurants in Pembroke do deals where it's like on a certain night, so it's all much of their stuff to your fundraiser. Mm-hmm. Like for everything that's bought, it'll get so much.
Okay. Yep.
That was the thing for fundraising.
How much are you going to need, Hunter?
$800, I think, right now. Mm-hmm. Which is mostly for the stone dust.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think there's really anything, just bases, new bases, which won't cost that much.
Mm-hmm.
Hunter, do you have a timeline for when you're thinking of getting this fundraised and complete?
I have until February to finish, because my age is true, but the plan is to finish by November.
Yep.
Great. So you're going to get a bunch of your buddies and go up there a couple of Saturdays?
Yes.
Spread the stone dust and everything?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Cool. How'd you come up with the idea?
We're looking for just ideas, and ever in the field, there's not really anything for them to do at recess. Mm-hmm. So fixing up the field would give the kids something to do at recess, and what they'll use at a gym class too.
Cool. Awesome.
That's great.
Mr. Murphy, I'm sure you've put him in touch with the PTO here at North, because I think they're pretty eager to do something on the field as well.
So absolutely. We have a meeting coming up, and that's on our agenda as well.
Awesome.
Actually, Hunter came up to school already, and he actually scoped out the field. And it was all his idea that he came up with. You know, he's a visionary. He saw what he wanted to do. He's now making it happen. So he knows all the different channels to go through. So we just have to support him tonight.
Cool.
Do you have any visual plans that we can look at?
Yes.
Aha. I was wondering what that book was for.
Mrs. Wendell's a big visual person.
Thank you. It says with pride, yes.
The diagram, it's got measurements we took of the field.
Can we pass it along?
Yep.
Oh, good.
And it's got the amount of stone dust.
There's an architect waiting to...
So,
I believe you.
Two other suggestions I would make. One is you might want to talk to Joe Sullivan from Pembroke Youth Baseball, because he may be able to even loan you some of the other pieces of equipment you need to make it a little bit easier, because they have some equipment that'll make it easier rather than spreading everything by hand or whatever. And see, maybe he could even try and help out in other ways. Just so, because it'll just help. I think that'll be good. And do you know Carol Dodge, who the field's named after?
I like the way you're thinking.
Carol served on this committee for many years before all of us.
Yeah.
And she was a big friend of the Pembroke Public Schools and did a really good job on the committee, and she's still active in town. You go to town meeting, she will sell coffee and baked goods for the Key Club. And I'm sure she would love to hear about this. She lives right on West Elm Street.
Yeah, and meet you.
And, I absolutely, she would be very interested in what's going on there. Okay?
Definitely make that.
Great suggestion.
Yeah.
Hunter, I'll send you her contact information.
Thanks.
Yeah, and I can get you Joe's contact too, so you can have that. Rick, second by Ginny. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Congratulations, you've passed the first phase.
Good job.
Good luck. Thank you for doing
this.
This is
hard work.
We always look at our fields, and if it wasn't for a lot of cooperation with people in town, our fields wouldn't look half as good as they do today. So thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Good luck. We'll make sure you can have your book before you go.
I'm just looking at the pictures.
Thank you, okay. So, knowledge and schedule of visitors? Okay. Adjustments to the agenda, any?
Your executive session, just to have, and a legal matter added to the warning.
And a legal matter. So three things.
For executive session?
Yeah, okay. Communications, we have several. Make sure that that stays in the book. So a few things. First, we have a formal request for a private school application. We'll pass these out.
So, do you mind if I?
You can speak to it.
So this is Athenaeum Learning Center, which would be located in Plaza that the British Beer Garden is on. They dropped off the application on Thursday. We have been in contact throughout the process as you guys were kind of formulating the policy for approval since it's our first time having one here in Pembroke. They had initially requested that tonight we have a temporary approval, which is something that we've not ever discussed a policy for, because they were looking to open on September 12th. I explained to them the timeline of this and that, you know, you guys wouldn't be comfortable taking a stand, and so we internally review the documents and make sure they meet the criteria and give you guys our opinion on the equivalency of the program. So they're very understanding of that and appreciate your looking at their proposal and taking action when the time is right at this level.
Yeah, it's a lot of information that kind of you're trying to digest.
It is.
And I think to give it to us on the 6th, expecting an approval by the 12th is probably unrealistic.
Agreed.
So, based upon that, or any other comments before I ask what we think our next step should be?
Can we walk through just what is the school? Is it sort of a standard sort of charter school? Is it K-12?
No, it's a little bit different. So it's kindergarten through 5th grade is what they're proposing for their rollout. They would like to grow it as the students get older. So I think the projected enrollment for this year was about 38 kids or so. It's tuition-based. It's $12,500 is the tuition. And it's more of a, I would say, like an outdoor classroom kind of hands-on learning feel as opposed to a traditional classroom setting. So they have some classroom space as well as behind the building is a large, what they're referring to as an outdoor classroom, right on the North River. Mm-hmm.
Yep. River,
yeah.
Have we done a tour?
We have not done a walkthrough yet. I explained this
in that. It's an odd place for school.
So there, it had been the previous home to the Trellis Learning Academy, which was a homeschooling network site. So there has been some sort of schooling in the space.
Is it in that strip
it's
mall?
It's right in the plaza.
It is. Yeah. Okay. How many kids? Any idea?
They're
what they're projecting? 38 in total.
K through 5.
Okay.
So, any comments or any other questions before we ask what next steps?
All right. Well, I mean, if you look back at our policy, we laid it out very clearly right now, so we don't need to rehash that, but what the process is, and yeah, to get it on, it's the 6th today, but you said they gave it to administration on the 1st, that's still only 11 days. That's a lot of, per our policy, that's a lot of work for administration to do. In 10 days, in my opinion. So it's going to be a little bit of time to get through all those things.
And there, we did have just some initial conversation about a similar situation in another town where the idea of conditional approval was kind of set on the fact that the school committee wanted to do a walkthrough while school was in session. So I think that's something we can kind of talk about at this level when we're closer to. I would like, I mean, Mary Beth, Jess, and I, we can go and walk through, but it would be look much different with students.
Right.
So.
Aaron, where are they today? Because I'm on page, I'm literally stumbling through this, but I'm on page 10 of 47, although there must be attachments in the back. And it says full-time enrollment 2016-2017, and then part-time enrollment 2016-2017. Are they somewhere today that they're moving in? Because that would be now.
Yeah, so they're in the space.
Oh, are they running the school, though? They can't actually run it without...
Run okay. The school. So they were hoping to have their enrolling students. They'd had some open houses and whatnot, but they're physically not opening the school until they have their approval.
Have the abutters kind of, like, has there been any hearing on sort of the use, or is there any zoning issue or anything?
I don't believe so.
I think it's at the planning board.
They have all of their permits and...
What was that, Jenny?
I think there might be discussion going on at the planning board because of abutters. and usage.
So I just would like the full picture.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? As regards, you just got this information.
To me, that's the next step. We wait for the administration recommendation.
So when would that be? Would that be next, would that be later this month, or would that be October? I'm just trying to put a timeline on this.
We would come back later this month.
We can do it.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'd like to read.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out what we do next. So I'm trying to put a timeline on this.
Can we also find out if the planning board is meeting and if they have concerns? I think it's important for us to understand what those are.
Okay, so obviously we have homework to do before the next meeting. And.
So I have a question. Is it our concern about how they get their permits or what they do to get their permits for building occupancy? Or is it only, because I've thought our policy. Right.
That they provide copies of their permits and certificates. I think what we've kind of centered our piece around is, you know, kind of that equivalency piece, making sure that the program that they're offering is equivalent to the high school. I, you know, have a little bit of worry about the financial solvency of the program. Mm-hmm. So looking at their financial information is important for me as well. And I'm sure Jess has some areas that she'd like to look at from a student services perspective. So.
But Paul, I think where it's relevant is if the planning board has a series of concerns and we say yes, go ahead, you know, you can have a school, and then we find out that there was a series of concerns, whether it be with the building, with the permitting, with just some other issue. We as government, right, should be aware of what each, the left and the right hand are doing. That's my whole point.
But I think what Aaron was saying is that they have to present us with those permits completed and everything.
Yeah.
So how they go about getting them? If they can't present them to us, then the application is not complete.
Yeah, coming through, I just happened to open to the page of the fire department.
Fire.
Yeah. So can we do this? Yeah, we have to come back at the next meeting. You come back with the report. We'll come back with questions after we've read this. Hopefully, as many of them ahead of time as possible, if possible. Okay.
Would you like me to have them join us at the next meeting, or do you want to have a first read at your next meeting and then?
Can we do a first read at the next meeting? Because we might have questions.
Yeah, that's how I would.
I mean, they're more than welcome to comment if they have questions. But
well,
I
don't
think front with them
a public meeting. I mean, they can come in and watch, but I think, understand our questions.
Okay.
But
I think they should be given the opportunity at the next meeting to address any questions we have.
If they're with them, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. If there's certain things that are addressed or concerns. But I would also be concerned about how quickly we turn it around at that point, because you're now keeping kids out of school.
Well, yes and no. We got the document on the 1st, and they know our policy, and we have a very long, detailed list of things that have to be done. And I really don't, I'd be surprised if they really had an expectation that that was going to be done in 10 days during our administrators opening our schools. So I agree with Aaron. I want to be very realistic, and I don't want to, I mean, what you guys find and what you guys see is going to be very important to my eyes and ears.
It's also it's legally incumbent on us as a committee to make sure that we vet the school that's actually coming into the borders of Pembroke, and that we truly understand whether or not that school is going to, in our opinion, provide an equal and good education for the children that are going to attend. I would say it's remiss a little bit on the center to expect that we would already have that or be able to sort of give a preliminary approval with never having seen the document. So
I don't think anybody's asked preliminary approval. All I'm trying to do is make sure we set a timeline and we do what we need to in order to do that vetting process.
I think it's totally.
So that's why I'm trying to say, what's the next step? Let's get to a meeting from now. If they want to come and answer any questions that we may have of them, that's wonderful. Well, but I don't think we would be in a position at that point. I know we won't be in a position at that point to approve.
Our process, right? I mean, we have a process for this stuff. I think we just follow it, right? So we have a first read at the next meeting. We go through thoughts, questions, commentary, and then we go to a second read.
Just asking again, if you have questions, try and get them to the administration ahead of time so we can have, they can have answers or at least plans for answers. Which brings up, do we want to put on the next agenda? There's a resolution that a lot of other school committees are passing with regard to question 2 in the charter school cap. I don't know if anybody has seen any of that on the listserv. Mm-hmm. So do we want to put on a discussion about what the resolution is that's circulating and whether we would like to participate?
So Do we actually have the, I mean, we can Google it. I mean, I've done a little bit of research on it already, but the actual wording of the question?
I'm sure we could get it.
I think we should bring it for an agenda item.
Okay, can we bring it for?
Because it's all over the television.
Could we get information about it beforehand?
Yep.
What is MASC, what's their recommendation?
I don't know if they'll have a recommendation.
They should, right?
They may.
Let's just keep.
What's that? Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I didn't even look at it because we were in discussion and I didn't want to miss the session.
It's fine. I just don't want to. Okay, so let's put that on the agenda and then we can act on it or choose to push it one more. Okay. A couple of the communications. We do have a thank you note, which I'll circulate from Peg Zostak, thanking us for the gift in working here. Two other pieces. One I will circulate. It's everyone needs to fill out or choose not to. The reappointment is as a special municipal employee for this year. So I'll circulate these, need to fill these out, and these need to go back to town hall. Circulate those as we go along. And yes, would you like to talk about?
Sure. So this is some communications that will be going out to families at the end of the week. It is a survey, so I just wanted to bring it to your attention, but it is required under federal special education guidelines and then devised by the Department of Ed in regards to what's called an Indicator 8. So special education is regulated by several different areas, including state and federal regulations. One of these is more of a check-in in data collection. So we are in what's considered cohort one, and we rotate on data collection that we provide to the department. Last year, we provided data on transition planning for our students, age 14 and post-grad, including those students that continue to participate up until age 22, and also preschool data in regards to entry and exit data. This year we continue with preschool, and then the other indicator that we're required to provide information on is Indicator 8, which has to do with family engagement. So this is a survey put forth by the department. We're required to give it out to families. Attached is a letter that I've devised to families, so I'm going to send a hard copy version so parents understand kind of the requirements, some background. It also provides kind of a hard copy for those people who cannot access online, although it is accessible by smartphone and obviously through the web. We are providing a hard copy as well. This will be broadcasted out. It's specifically for families of students in special education, as the only people allowed to participate are students on IEPs, families of students on IEPs, pre-K to 22. So I just wanted to make you aware of some of the things that were going out in the next week.
Do we do it with the data?
So the data will be shared back to us. It's more the department's way of kind of monitoring and then improving their professional development, their feedback to districts. It's not tied to our coordinated program review, which you may remember happens every 6 years. We're in the process of that. Last year I had to submit data points and enormous amounts of paperwork justifying that we're following regulations in special ed, civil rights, and English language learners. This is more data collection to provide the department with kind of informal information. It's a federal requirement. We are not, they don't circle back per se and find us at fault for X, Y, and Z, but they will provide us with the information and expect that we're using it to kind of monitor our programming.
So we will make adjustments. I mean, if there was something that would just completely, like, blanket it, I mean,
correct.
89% or 95% of the respondents said X, Y, or Z, we would take that and modify the program based on that.
Most of the time, we just get general information. If you've met the requirement, for instance, the transition planning, we just received information back that you've submitted all the transition planning, you're meeting the guidelines, and we were allowed to apply for a competitive grant, which Marie Husted and Megan Strawn at the secondary level applied for, and we did obtain.
Okay.
So we're doing some additional assessments and supporting students at the 14 to 22 range based on the grant application. So.
Great.
So because this is required by federal law, we do not have to approve it, correct?
That's my understanding.
Any other questions on it? And the questions are fairly general in nature. It's kind of tough to get much out of this, right?
Right.
Any questions at all?
No.
Okay.
Thank you.
I think that is all the communication. Bill's schedules are circulating.
Can I ask a communications related question, if I may? We got something from Town Hall. I'm going to complete the name of the law is going to escape me. But the governor just signed a law that...
Municipal reform.
Yeah, that's the Municipal Reform Act, that has certain provisions in it as far as warrant signatures and a couple other things.
That's where I was going with the bill schedule.
Oh, sorry.
I was going to bring up the bill schedule piece.
Okay.
Absolutely. Was there anything else you want to bring up?
No, sir. I'm just trying to get a feel for, does that change what we do from a process perspective or even a meeting perspective, that type of thing?
It can, because one of the provisions in there, and I was going to talk about good timing, on bill schedules. So one of the challenges we have in the summertime is getting 3 signatures on the bill schedules. And the part of the act allows for warrants now to be signed by one member, and then that member report back to the full committee on what was in there. We can choose to adopt it. Can we choose to adopt it selectively, or do we do it all the time?
It has to be all the time.
Okay. So we would have to do it for all 12 months, not just for the 3 months of the summer.
What if we did it that way and the report was the summary page, the detailed line item ones? Is that easy to PDF and send out?
Yes.
Because that could be the report.
The other piece of that is that I did reach out to our legal counsel, because there are some districts that take electronic signatures now, and there's been a couple of, you know, arguments on both sides of it, but it seems from a legal standpoint that your electronic signature would be valid on the warrant, so I think that might be a better option for this group as opposed to just having one sign.
Define electronic signature. Is it actually you're going in like a VeriSign?
Yes.
And going, okay.
Yes.
How do we get that service then?
Question two, good.
Well, we have it through School Office Pro, so I can post the warrants through there.
Yeah, you'll get no signatures then.
So are we thinking about changing it for one instance a year?
We can't.
It's all...
Right, because I enjoy going through them. I want to go through them. I want to stay on top of it, you know. I wouldn't want there'd be, okay, so that would be then another member who has to do it and then report back. You know, so it seems more work to me for someone.
No,
not me.
Unless you want to sign, unless you want to be the designee.
No. I like going through my own pace.
But I guess Aaron's point of electric signature could be the better option.
Yeah,
because it'll meet the challenge of people not being around during the summer months, but it'll also address Sue, your concern of wanting to be always part of that process.
Mm-hmm. In lieu of electronic signature, we don't have an option of what, can we just get the form, sign it, and send it back? Scan it and send it back?
I need physical signatures. Ink, pen, and ink.
Yeah, but is a facsimile...
We'll take a copy.
Has to be a wet signature. That's why I was... That's
or
why
a verified signature, I guess. But right. I do like... I will say, and I think for me it's about controls, right? Mm-hmm. It's about whether or not we have the right internal control structure and whether or not things are receiving an independent review. Because again, the fiduciary responsibility of the district is our job. I liked Paul's idea. If we go to one, to be able to send out maybe not every one of the bills, but the cover sheets that you can see. Yeah, what's being paid and everything else.
Even if we could do that before the meeting, would make it go a lot quicker. I think.
Those are the ones we read like this, right?
So you'll remember that was the process we had. Up until maybe last September or so, when you guys had a kind of a conversation at this table and felt like you weren't able to review them electronically. So we went back to not sending you the update the Friday before. So where we can, that's something easy we can go back to doing now.
So will we have, by the next meeting, the update on electronic signature?
Yes.
Yeah.
Let's put that as an agenda item.
This is fine.
I wouldn't want to get, my only concern on the electronic signature is I would like an actual written legal opinion, because I don't want to have happen is to submit them, then be told, oh, we can't process bills because of whatever.
Yeah, which is what? Should we? That's fine. Let's see what they come back with.
We'll still need the summaries, just to be aware.
Yeah, I can go back to sending them out.
We would, but then that would change kind of...
And you're signing that particular document that's sent out to you?
Correct. Yeah. That would have to be part of the package. Okay. Other comments in this?
Can I bring up just a community communication?
Absolutely. Yep.
We had briefly spoke just to put it on our radar screen. So there's a request to have some guidance from a community group regarding possibly fundraising for a press box at Pembroke High School. And I understand we do have the policy regarding fundraising and dedicating memorial items. This would be for Patrick Lane. So my communication with Molly, his wife, would be that I'd bring it for consideration here, but is it okay for everyone if we bring it to policy to review with her? And then if there's any information that the administrators need regarding what people are talking about now, as it is football season, I just wanted to make sure that between the athletic department and superintendent that we want to manage everybody's expectations so that there's not an assumption that this can absolutely happen and just because a parent group wants to do it, that it's a done deal. So I have spoken directly with Molly. She certainly understands. It's quite an emotional experience, and I think we're all coming from the same place where we want to do good, but there's certainly timelines and considerations. So I'm putting it out there now, and I expect that if it's okay with you, we'll review certainly with Molly, what our policy is, and whatever you guys want to talk to me about, we can have a further conversation. Okay?
I think policy is very appropriate.
Thank you.
Any other comments now?
We'll bring back.
Okay. So, approval of the minutes of June 7th.
Move to approve minutes of June 7th as presented.
Second.
Motion by Paul, second by Suzanne. Any comments? Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Okay, unanimous. You. Okay, moving into the superintendent's report. You want to take anything out of order?
Yep, I do. So, first I would like to introduce you to the two gentlemen to your left. The first is Justin Dominguez. For those of you that have not met him, he's our new athletic director and facilities manager. And then Mark Talbage. His face should look familiar to the rest of you from the interview process.
Yeah.
High school principal. So Justin is here just to kind of put a face with a name for you guys. We have on here the acknowledgement of fall coaches, so I think it might be nice if Justin just gives a little bit of an overview of what fall sports has looked like so far, and you can, the roster is much fuller now that it's in front of you than it was, I think, when we first sent it out in June. I think we're still missing one, though, right?
And Mark's just here to prove that he's actually still standing after 3 days of school.
Mark's here to talk about the handbook.
I feel good about where my legs start, where we're at with the coaches we need to hire. We are short one varsity football coach, but from the time I've spent at practice and speaking with the staff, I know they're doing the best they can to manage that. And from what I've seen, they're very efficient at practice with them. So I give a lot of credit to Coach King and his staff. That was kind of an interesting turn with how they lost a staff member, but they've turned that around and they're doing well. It's going to be a big test for them Friday night, I think, against a pretty athletic Pope John Paul team. So that'll be interesting to watch. We kicked off today, the fall season, girls soccer, lost to Duxbury 4-0. Tough opener for them, but I think there's a lot of lessons learned there. And we do have a freshman girls coach who started today, along with a JV coach, who I think will bring some young energy to that squad and hopefully help with the recruitment of girls from our youth soccer program, which I hear is robust. And I'm excited. I've touched base with the youth soccer folks, and I want to talk about ways in which we can keep encouraging the numbers to grow there.
It's, when Aaron gave some of the numbers, it's troubling. Having coached in the youth soccer program, and, you know, some of the, all for the years that are at the high school, the numbers do not correlate to what was there last year, what was there in the youth sports. So there's something has to happen. Okay. I consider it dangerous that we have three teams right now because the numbers are so low. You cringe going into a game with 14.
Yeah,
and now you're going to a season.
when we had two young ladies who were absent from school, and so that threw the JV roster in a disarray, and we had to move freshmen around. So
we had that same concern last year, this committee, and we saw the train coming, and we sat there and watched it till it blew up. So I guess just want to make sure we're being proactive on this one, because last year it was probably one of the liveliest soccer seasons in recent memory.
I actually had a daughter that was on the team last year and decided not to play this year. And in fairness to Destin, I mean, you're coming into this so late in the game, like, this has nothing to do with you.
Yeah.
But the way I would look at it, actually, because I do think with you and your stewardship, we have a new beginning. And I think it could be a new beginning for the program. I mean, to your point, and sort of making the ties with Pembroke Youth Soccer, which has always been incredibly robust. I mean, my kids played from kindergarten straight through. I do think that there's a lot of opportunity, and this may just be a transition year for us. You know, I mean, those are tough sometimes, but sure. I think for the program to kind of really focus with the right focus, we can turn it around.
Yeah, definitely. The numbers are there coming up. You just have to figure out how to bridge so that we're not losing so many. It'd be interesting to know, you know, losing so many from last year's team, girls who chose not to come back. Mm-hmm. That, to me, is a bigger problem than girls coming from 8th grade to 9th grade.
Sure.
Right? I mean, it's just like anything else. The natural cutoffs in sports are 6th to 7th and then 8th to 9th. You know, in some sports it's bigger than others, whether it be baseball or softball or whatever. But it's just, what are we attributing losing numbers to? You know, because we're putting those girls. So they had, what, 11 then, or 12 at the JV game?
They had 11 on the bench, but they had one on the bench.
So thankfully, it was a cool day. The end of this week, they have a game on Friday, too?
They do. Away
at Silver Lake. So 90 degrees, you play with 11, you know, so.
No one's going to be complaining about playing time.
Yeah.
You won't get those complaints.
Yeah, so I just concern, so.
I have a question about cross country.
Sure.
Is one coach enough? We might have to figure out the exact numbers. I think in the past we've had two coaches as well. So I know Rooney's been a coach as well as Zapati.
Yeah, I think I'll have to speak with Coach Zapati about that. You know, he hasn't brought it up, and he's very communicative, which is awesome. No, he is
very communicative.
Yeah, but in this particular area, I know he's not.
Yeah.
They've done, even on indoor track, some history, like they've had 120 and two coaches in indoor track.
And outdoor track's even more.
And they won't turn any kid away, which is great, which is the reason why they're the Pied Pipers of Pembroke sports. But it's one of those things where, you know, we want kids to keep running, you know.
Are they engaged enough, I guess, by the coach? I think he does a great job. I'm not knocking. I just want to make sure he's got the support that he needs with the number of kids.
Well, I will tell you, just a bit of a kudos to Coach Zapati.
To do some of that work, so it's not the same thing as having an advisor or a coach.
Which I really appreciated. So both of my girls now run. One was the soccer player, the other has been running. So they're both now running. He sat them down, like day two, and was like, girls, what's going on? Like, what is going on with times and everything else? And he said, and asked every one of them, what'd you eat today? It's like, you can't just eat a granola bar, a piece of fruit, a yogurt, and then expect to go out and run 10 miles. And literally is on them, all over nutrition and everything else. So he's clearly engaged and involved. But to your point, when there's that many kids, you might need another set of hands.
You got them up at 6:30 on Saturday so they could eat and digest before practice.
Trust me, I was up. I know.
Okay. To be continued.
But good job, Jess.
Yes.
Good.
Thank you.
So you started, now you get to start planning for winter?
So we did talk about posting the winter openings, hopefully maybe next week or so.
Yeah, some basketball openings and first girls basketball post, so those are
just to clarify, we post everything because we're a seasonal employer.
That's
here, remember? But you know, we have some people that are wanting to come back that were here in the past, so we shouldn't be as many holes in our coaching roster as we for the fall, but
should be good.
Very good.
I will say from the cuts perspective this year, I didn't get any calls or complaints about how people were cut. It was very well informed.
That's the first time in a lot of years.
Yes.
I heard a little bit of squawking, but that's okay. There's always going to be somebody squawking.
Yeah. No doubt.
Yeah, okay.
I think for the first time at least in a while since I've been here that I felt like there was a rubric that communication was clear with parents, with kids, expectations were clear, and that a process was definitely followed from start to finish. So understanding that our philosophy is to keep as many kids involved, I do feel like in the instances where we made cuts, which were fewer than they have been in the past, we do have some relatively large teams. If you look at field hockey and even some of the higher levels of boys soccer, I think the communication was what has been key that we have been lacking before.
Actually, one question, because we didn't see, I remember most of the other numbers, but not these. How are the football numbers? Because those had been on the decline for a couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
And at one point, we were considering just going to two levels because we were getting hit that bad. Are they up at all this year? What's a freshman?
Freshman's been a steady growth in, 2.5 weeks I've been here.
So that's a good trajectory. So
yeah, we're starting the entire time here.
You're adding another skilled player today. So it's literally grown. I think their first day they had underneath 20. And we're in the mid-20s now.
Okay.
So, the freshman squad is, I think, for what we started with, is a pretty decent size.
Mm-hmm.
There's, from what I'm learning as I get to know people and I talk to some of the older young men who play other sports and don't play football, but who played youth football, there's a strong push here. Like, there isn't a lot of talents to specialization. There's a hoops, which is a big force of some of these guys, and some baseball. Some baseball guys who maybe want to focus on baseball. So I get that. I think, again, I'll go back to the recruiting part. It's what I talked about in my interview with Mark. And that's part of your job as a varsity coach, as a varsity head coach. You have to have a hand in these youth programs. You don't have to run them, but you have to have a good relationship. The kids should know who you are in the younger levels. They should say, that's Coach King, that's Coach Seward. I know those guys. I can't wait to go play for those guys. Because think about it, when you grew up, I knew all the coaches in my town.
Mm-hmm.
When they came around, I was always moving. So that's important for us. And we'll keep imparting that on our coaching staffs. And I think, as we go throughout the year, we'll build a little bit more. And hopefully we'll see that freshman number continue to grow and get more crossover. Because I see those youth football guys out every night. There's a ton of kids playing there.
Mm-hmm. And the flag numbers are huge.
Right? Yeah, the flag numbers are really big.
So, there needs to be crossover from the youth soccer and from our youth football programs in the high school. And I get some of those some of those flag kids probably play soccer too. Right?
They do.
I played soccer. I was a 230-pound left back on the soccer field. It wasn't going to be applicable to high school, but so I get that part of it. But at the same time, our numbers can definitely, I think, increase a little bit from the media.
I think from our standpoint, we always look at numbers participating in each sport and the number of children or athletes who are competing in multiple sports, just to try and keep them engaged in the school. Mm-hmm. Specialization absolutely happens, but you still hope even if they specialize, they're at least able to play that second high school sport.
Sure.
Right, a lot of kids who do the indoor track to stay in shape for spring sports.
Right.
Yeah.
Coming from the Division I level, there aren't a lot of guys that we recruited who weren't multi-sport athletes. They're all...
The guy we were talking about earlier was a five-sport high school athlete.
Exactly.
And had his choice in two or three different sports for college. So it is...
There's only 18 guys that get sent to Michigan to play for the USA hockey team every year that are not in college yet. So, there's not that many people at that level. So we need to recognize that and know that there's a future for you if you want when you leave Pembroke High School, and that these other sports will help you.
I mean, just this engagement with the school, staying in shape, as well as, keeping that pride, and then it looks good in the resume going for colleges. So, great, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
So I'm going to tell Justin our parting remarks that you are more than welcome to stay if you would like to stay, but I do know you did email me at 5:19 this morning, so you can not stay if you choose
good
to
not stay.
I hope it doesn't look disrespectful.
Justin, run. Run, run, run. Yeah.
Thanks, Justin.
Thank you.
See you.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Dude, we acknowledge.
Yeah.
You did.
Okay, is there a motion to acknowledge the fall coaches for the 2016 season?
So moved.
Second.
So motion by Patrick, second by Paul. Any further discussions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, abstained?
So keeping with the spirit of out of order, would we like to do the handbooks next, and then we can grill Mr. Talbot and send him
his lunch?
That'd be fun. So, I don't know how to put that.
Are you folks here for anything specific on the agenda? We can take something out of order. Did you?
No, is it going to be on cable?
It will be, yep.
No, he's here for a requirement on a merit badge.
Oh, all right.
Go to a government.
Yeah, yep, yep.
And I actually can't hear very well here.
Sorry, you can speak up.
Well, we see that you're here.
Yes.
Yeah, well, you have to discuss as one of the items with his council.
Absolutely, and yep, we'll be on cable, nice, loud and clear.
Okay.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Okay.
Thanks, guys.
Sarah, are you here just for fun?
What?
Are you here just for fun, or is there anything you want to?
Just don't get your mom mad at us.
And we're actively recruiting for a student member to sit on the school committee, so. Mr. Talbot, there's a hand
just
raised.
Just saying.
Yeah, we have a volunteer here, Mr. Talbot.
So the.
Okay. What are the handbooks?
Yes, the handbooks in your packet. You have, I think, obviously the elementary one is the easiest one to start with. Mr. Murphy is here representing the group if there's any questions. There were minimal changes to the handbook this year. I think the actual only change was the names of the PTO boards. And there was one typo, which we will fix. I think we did some extensive work.
Minnie was okay with it.
Yes, Minnie's fine. I think we did some extensive work last year on handbook language at all three levels as far as regulations and whatnot. So I didn't expect many changes to the elementary handbook. So by many, I mean none.
Okay.
I haven't gotten any questions about the handbook, but just one kind of overarching theme is that it is very clear that our handbooks have been written by many different authors at many different times. And I think now with having our communication specialist Sharon started today, this is an opportunity to kind of rein in our voice a little bit and have one author, one editor, and have some consistency to the language and the substance across not just the handbooks, but the program of studies. I think we kind of jump in and edit when we have to, but looking at it as a cohesive document hasn't happened in a long time. So I think we're looking forward to that with the capacity that we have now.
I would even say that almost templatizing it too, so it looks the same. And I can't remember if it was the high school or the middle school, but the way the table of contents was set up, you can almost click and move.
Yep.
Yeah, which was great. It makes it just a lot easier.
So do you want to do them one at a time? Do you vote on them one at a time?
Do you have a revised one for the high school?
I have a revised one. Yes.
Well, you know what? Let's vote on the elementary.
Feeling.
Yes, work our way that way. So is there a motion to approve the elementary handbook?
So moved.
Motion by Patrick, second by Ginny. Any further discussions?
Yep. Appreciate the red line.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Aye. Abstained? Okay. So the middle school, any comments or questions on this one?
So just to draw your attention to the two major changes, there's a section in here about Title I and what that means at the middle school level, understanding that this is a very basic explanation and that during our CPR program review, that we'll get some more guidance on the language that we'd be using moving forward. The other piece that's different in there, I think, is... that was it.
Yeah, she didn't have any.
Okay, is
not
there a motion?
Not policy related.
But everything else was small.
Grades or something.
Yeah,
yeah, something small.
Yeah.
Is there a motion to approve the handbook for Pembroke Community Middle School?
So moved.
Second. Motion by Patrick, second by Suzanne.
Erin.
Any further discussion?
Espert.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Beautiful.
Just reminding me what the second piece was that's different in the middle school handbook, and it's the section in there about Espert. So you'll remember that Governor Baker's opioid law requires that we test in the fall of 2017, that we survey two grades between 6th and 12th grade about their use of drugs and alcohol. So we'll be piloting that this year because we did receive a grant last year, so we're going to pilot that at the middle school. In the 8th grade, Judy, I believe we're going to do the Espert. So there's some language in there about the effort, and more information will go out to parents as the screening time comes closer.
More general information in the handbook.
Okay, moving on to the high school.
Welcome, Mr. Talbot. The only change between the copy that you have in front of you and the most revised version is that under the cheating and plagiarism section that there is a format for appeal at all three levels. So I believe that's on page 22. The red line just has it at the first offense. It says that you can appeal to an administrator. It's at all three.
I like the clarification of internet, too, on that one.
It's on page 24. I still think on cheating under number two, I still think that the fact that talking about a test after the fact is considered cheating is not applicable. Shouldn't be a cheating. If two kids walk out of a test and say, hey, what'd you get for answer number five? Under these guidelines here, that would be considered cheating.
So I think the overarching theme is that we create a handbook for the masses, right? And that there's obviously some follow-up pieces as far as teacher expectations, and that a teacher would be sharing with the class her expectations in relation to an assignment or a test. So yes, the scenario that you just explained, Paul, would not be what I would think would be cheating, but if I were in, you know, fourth period biology and my friend stayed home sick today and I called my friend and told her all the questions on the test, then that would be cheating, and that is also talking about a test. So
I didn't look at it that way, although that's a valid point. I looked at it as what if there's four sections or two sections of the same.
Yep, same.
Yeah. Yeah. You don't expect the same test in the two sections. However, you would expect the same themes.
But I think to Paul's
point. That's where I looked at it, Paul.
I think to Paul's point, though, because the irony is I read it both ways. The first way I read it, I'm like, oh, wait, this is crazy, which is Paul's scenario of, you know, we walk out of class and we're like, hey, you know, to your point, where'd you get on number three, right? Mm-hmm. And then I did think of that, you know, and I'll take it just, you know, take my own household, right? So I have two kids in the same grade. One has a period four and one has a period six. And in period five, they're like, oh, by the way, you better look at this. And I'd look at this. And I'd be, that's cheating, right? And that is, it may be wording, right? I think to Paul's point, it may be saying, somehow really making it clear that discussing a test after the fact with someone who is yet to take the test, that is absolutely unequivocally cheating.
Yeah.
And maybe just tweaking that wording a little bit probably makes it clear.
So you'd make you'd make a sub-bullet below two.
Yeah. Well, I don't even know that I make a sub-bullet below two. Maybe it's I would change the wording of two.
You can simply add a phrase, right, that says, so it says talking, giving, or receiving information among students prior to or following a test or quiz with students who have yet to take said test or quiz.
That's perfect. I think that's perfect, Mark.
Actually, you can even just change among students to taking, giving, or receiving any information
with a student who has yet to take
with
a
student who has yet to take this. So then how would you interpret that for two kids who may be studying for a test before it's, you know,
they haven't
right
taken it yet.
They haven't taken it.
Yeah, but the way it's worded, so would you take away prior to?
Yeah.
So would you just strike prior to? Because, I mean, I think, are we okay with kids sitting down to study for a test together?
Of course.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, because that, to me, says you can't do that because that's taking or receive any information prior to.
So I feel like the prior to may have been a previous attempt at getting at talking to students that haven't taken the test yet.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's just worded wrong.
And
I think the intent is, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Mine was just, I was going to say we want to encourage students who have just taken the test to talk about it. Because that, I mean, that's a learning process too. But they're going to talk to each other who've just taken it. They just can't talk to Joey who didn't take it yet. Or Sally.
Right.
I think the intent's right, it's just the wording.
Yeah. Talking, giving, or receiving any information among students following a test or quiz with students who have yet to take.
I would just do, rather than among students, I'm trying to word it out, with a student who has not taken.
Has yet to take.
With a student who has yet to take. A test or quiz. From a future student representative's perspective, does that make sense, Ashley?
I would say assessment, because you need to do an essay, like sometimes the essay question.
Look at that.
that.
Hey, can you come to the table and just get the best one? That's a good point.
I mean, they might try to say, oh, well,
test or assessment? Oh, that's a good point.
Just assessment covers everything.
Oh, assessment. Really good.
Does that satisfy your studying?
That's the communications person. She's got to work.
I think so.
Change everything to assessment.
It's true, but the assessment.
The studying.
Right. Just assessment. That's a good point.
That's okay.
When do we appoint the student representative?
And say, I can't settle this on.
I'm not sure that's going to happen.
Post? Did Gary post?
No, not yet. That's what I questioned around.
Talking, giving, or receiving any information, sorry.
No, I'm just making sure these are here.
Talking, giving, or receiving any information with a student who has yet to take said assessment prior to or following the assessment. That's all, right?
Got it? Everybody okay with that?
Yeah. So you have to take the said assessment prior to.
Yep.
Okay, fine.
Okay. Yep. Other questions? Other comments?
Sorry, I have one. This goes back to an issue from last year. So under discipline, in the tardy section on discipline, I totally get where we are, and I totally get why we do what we do, and you have to at this age group. I completely understand. My biggest concern, though, and we had it happen several times last year, and in my view, at times it was completely illogical, you had kids that, so learning lean is a nightmare. It looks like the distress way of Pembroke. It is bumper to bumper, and it's absolutely hell. So, and it's unpredictable. Some days fine, some days not fine. Sometimes those kids, as a result, are literally bolting for the door, and the door is closing, and they're like up against the glass ward. They are 5 minutes late. There's a point that I think we need some logic to prevail in some of these situations. Now, it's one thing if it's chronic that every day you're in a traffic jam. That's not what I'm talking about.
Or
but I just worry about
logic. Or if you're holding a Dunkin' Donuts cup.
No, so I think, Mark, you've made some adjustments. I know when I was there last week, you were locking the door at 7:50.
But those kids still talk.
Yep.
The issue of running late is one that I am still experiencing. And I'm talking to Aaron today about some suggestions that I have about trying to improve the flow of traffic. Granted, those suggestions are based on 3 days observations, so I'm not going to make them yet in any public forum. I agree with you that to a certain extent, the logistics of entering our building are difficult. But that's not a surprise to anybody. And I think with the tardiness, what we are proposing is to allow our students more than the two they're allowed now. Unexcused tardies. Bump that number to 5.
Yeah.
So that when a student says, I got caught in traffic, or I got a flat tire, or my alarm didn't go off, these things that happen to everybody, we're allowing that to happen more frequently without consequence.
But I am
loath to say that because Tardy Tuesday happens because of what's happening at Hallmark in the mornings, I am reluctant to say it's okay to be tardy on that day.
Yep.
What I want to say to those children is you need to leave 10 minutes early.
I agree.
I'm not surprised by that.
So there were two situations last year which caused a lot of this. One was the Hallmark chorus was the largest ever. I think it was the entire school was in the chorus. So we had two schools trying to show up at the same time. So can we just do the first thing? Let's be logical here. Is it possible to work with the Habermock, right? Work with Jessica and see how many kids she's going to have in the chorus and see if there's a way they could plan their timing a little bit different so that their parents aren't dropping off at the same time we're going to high school. So that was the one issue. And the second was we had some issue around when there were weather days. Now,
there was a car accident once.
Yeah.
That caused the biggest backup.
But those are one-offs where I think we have to trust your judgment. However, I had this because I had the same discussion with my daughter who drove last year. That the Hallmark thing happened every week.
Yep.
So they knew it was going to happen. So either plan accordingly, or now we have to plan accordingly and work together between the two schools to take away that obstacle. So if They last year were going to start chorus at 7:30. Can they start at 8 and allow those children to miss homeroom and then start, you know, so they get their...
There's a way to work it out.
Exactly. Rather than just saying, let's go from 5 to 10.
Yeah, and I'm not saying that at all. I'm just asking for the one-offs and the truly one-offs, and I agree with you. When you know it's every Tuesday, we'll suck it up and leave 10 minutes earlier so that you get to school on time because your boss is never going to say, oh, geez, it's Tuesday, so sure, go ahead and be late. You get fired, right? So I'm with you. I'm 100% with you. But on the one-offs, I'm just asking for some logic.
How about this? That's all. We were talking revenue last week with the whole town. Here's our revenue suggestion. We put Mary Lou's inside the door
actually,
at the high school.
That is not a bad idea.
It shuts down at 7:30. So everybody will be in line with that. Does that make you feel better?
Freaking Obama. Are you kidding me?
Good.
Mark, I'm sorry.
I think God recognized that.
It's only 8:30.
Let's start talking about the revenue.
Ready, go to Obama kills our revenue.
Weather concerns, you know, there are every high school in America deals with that, and every administration in America gets on the PA and says, mm-hmm. we're going to hold toddies right. today until 8 o'clock because of the weather.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I certainly think that's reasonable. Different, you know.
Siri's really upset about this too.
That's not the same thing.
I think you have to hold the line. You have to have rules. You have to have guidelines. And there are one-offs where there's a situation.
Right.
I mean, I grew up in an area where there isn't that much traffic. People who live in this area should realize that there's traffic everywhere. Yeah. So everywhere you got to go, you right. plan.
I think when I saw the change from 2 to 5. At first, I sat back and I'm like, I have to think about this one because it seemed to be counter to what we're trying to do. But then on the other side, I'm like, okay, it's making more sense to me because of some of the anomalies that are one-offs for that mm-hmm. that child who's coming up Hobomock Street from Center Street or the one coming from Standish, and because we've had issues on each end. That makes sense. And if there's a way, the biggest thing to me is if we can get the Hobomock chorus, which we want the numbers to be big, so we're not trying to discourage anyone. Like, let's get more kids, but let's figure out a way so the start time of them does not coincide with us. Listen, we now make election day, right, a no school day because we had traffic when we used to vote at Hobomock. It was a nightmare.
Yep.
So now we've made that change. Let's try and make the next change.
Well, I'm encouraging you to say that because it certainly is something that my staff has brought to my attention. Again, not having lived it, I don't really know any different than anybody else.
Yeah.
But to make sense, it's the way we can talk with Danielle across the street and see if we can coordinate time so that it works for everybody. Mm-hmm. And hopefully we can. And if we can, then we'll have to perhaps think of something else. But there are a few things that I want to do to help the toddy situation, and you're right, I get the antithetical, at least appearingly antithetical position that we give the kids more toddies, even though we're trying to curb toddies. I get that. One of the things we did this year was we did not assign parking spaces to seniors because what I was told that created a he stole my spot kind of thing, and then we're circling the lot, and that takes 4 or 5 or 6 minutes. We also, this is not going to occur.
Maybe
this is going to cut back on the amount of time kids are out of the classroom. So prior to this year, the doors were locked at 7:40. And so we know that most kids are late. They're late during that 10-minute window of 7:40 to 7:50. So instead of locking the door at 7:40, where Ms. Hurley at the front door is running out passes by herself, by hand, to 50 kids, and those 50 kids are now backed up into the parking lot. Came upon a mockery. We are letting those kids proceed directly to class, and they're being mocked toddy by the classroom teacher. They're still late. It's not anything other than a toddy. It's a toddy. The difference is who's mocking the kids toddy. So instead of one person mocking 55 kids late, we have 75 teachers mocking 55 kids late. Yep. And that'll get a kid who was at the door at 7:40, or 7:41 or 7:42, and because he or she's in a line, is not getting to class at 7:50. We're trying to eliminate that. Who got in at 7:39, because the doors weren't locked yet at 7:39, by the time he or she got there to their class, way down that corner of the building, they were sent back to the door to get their pass, and by that time the line is now to the curb. That kid would have been at 7:40 in 10 seconds. He's not getting 7:50. So, we're really trying to make it reasonable for everybody, and I do think that if we're going to look like heroes tomorrow if this gets approved, And we announce tomorrow to the student board, we don't announce this yet, of the five tidies, they're going to think we're the greatest. The back end of that, however, is going to be accountability factor.
Yeah.
Right? The idea of accruing 30 and 40 and 50 hours of detention before you serve, to me, has never made sense. It's antithetical to everything.
Yep.
So we are going to re-examine the way that students serve their consequences as a part of this. So.
Well, that's fair. I like to hear that because that preserves the time in learning, which we work really, really hard.
Exactly the point.
Right. To get kids in front of teachers learning.
So based on that, who wants to be the hero and make the motion?
So moved.
So motion by Ginny was second by Patrick. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? All right.
I told them it was going to be way more painful than this. Yeah. Are you sure there's not anything else?
You addressed all my questions. You should have left them for him.
It was fine.
We'll call it the SJ tardy.
Open.
Okay.
So, Mr. Talbot, you're more than welcome
with
to
the
say,
Mary Lou's.
With the Mary Lou's, that's a great idea.
The same with you, Mr. Murray. Mark's coming here later.
Make sure he doesn't get out of the building.
He doesn't know how to get out of the building. You got to show him out.
Thank you.
Thank you all again.
Good to see you.
And, it's good to be happy. Thank you very much for the opportunity. And it's been great. So thank you all.
Thank you, Thursday.
Thank you. Thank you.
Tomorrow will be a good day.
Ginny, are you leaving too?
No, I'm coming back.
Where are we going?
Let's keep going. This is fun. I like jumping around. So I think it makes sense to do the opening of school recap.
I was going
to
say, we'll get a big wheel from now on.
What do you think? Woo!
We can do the ping pong balls.
Yeah, we'll call it bingo ball.
It wasn't funny.
B52, opening school of recap. Opening of school recap. So as many of you remember, this is the first year in a long time that we've front-loaded the bulk of the PD days. So last week we had teachers in Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday prior to student arrival. There was resounding response from Monday's professional development day. I think we kind of took a little bit of a different approach than what we've taken in the past, and it was more of an ease back in for teachers, where the theme of the day was just appreciation and, you know, thanking. But there was some meat to it as well. It was, I think, creatively kind of infused. So we spent the morning with a wonderful speaker, Tim Clue, whose message is all about failing up, which is, you know, just reassuring a teacher to let kids be kids and try different things and be creative with solutions and just reinforcing the impact that teachers have on students. Then we spent the afternoon in technology workshops. I think I received probably 40 or 50 emails just about how wonderful the first day back was. So I think that was reassuring for Mary Beth and Jess and I. I think we put a lot of time and effort into planning it. And you'd be surprised, the thing that you worry the most about is lunch. I mean, getting lunch delivered on time is like the bane of your existence.
So I got a text from a teacher that afternoon saying it was the best opening day that they've ever been at in all their years.
And I have to be honest.
And I'd have to say the highlight was the ice cream truck. And I want to know when we get one.
We didn't do anything differently than things we've done in the past. So we've had speakers in the past. We've given out lunch in the past. We've had kind of the Ed Camp model in the past. Literally, the only thing we did different was the ice cream truck at the end. And, you know,
your goody bags.
But
we've done that kind of stuff before. So I think, so the
message I heard was that they felt appreciated and they did feel
the fact.
Thank you. They said thank you was the theme of the day.
It was the delivery of it. So I think in the past, we've kind of come in hard on the first day and said, here are our test scores. Let's figure out how to fix this. And to go from the beach to that is a big adjustment. So I think it was just a welcomed kind of ease back in to the day. The second day was spent in district-wide teams. We did an extensive amount of curriculum work over the summer, especially at the K-6 level with the humanities and the math. So I think, I don't know if you,
sure.
Feedback from that day was also...
Yeah, that day was a little bit, there was no ice cream truck, so right away there was
we
a...
We did say
was
on the presentation, it's going to be great, tomorrow's going to stink.
Yeah. But people were very, I attended the grade one curriculum meeting, and the teachers, it was all teacher-driven. Teachers created benchmark assessments in humanities and in math, three for each, one for each term. They identified the answer keys, they've identified the scoring rubrics, they presented those to their peers. There were teams of 3 to 5 teachers for each grade level that worked on that this summer. It was a lot of a huge undertaking. And it was exciting. They were very pleased, the group I was in. There's some areas where we still have to work out a few kinks, but it's not the substance of it. It's more sort of how are we scoring? How does that relate to a rubric that relates to a number that relates to, you know, some of those pieces are a little bit more difficult.
I get all kidding aside, the ice cream truck, you know, making people, I mean, right, it's a field.
It's appreciation, yeah.
Yeah, and absolutely, and it shows the appreciation, right, because it speaks more than words. Do you think some of the enthusiasm carried over from last year, because it seemed as though it was a strong year last year, we didn't have the budget things hanging over our head. I think it was a successful year with the new math program at the elementary schools. Mm-hmm. It seemed to be, except for the first 6 weeks of the school year, right, between some issues and some in the transition, once we got to kind of that January, February timeframe, it just seemed like everything was a tremendous amount of momentum in carrying it over into this year. Is that?
Yeah, I think what we felt in the spring was the anticipation of a fresh start, and I think that's truly what Monday was for a lot of people, a fresh outlook on the way we're approaching this, the way decision-making happens. I mean, the next item I'll talk about is kind of our district focus areas. Just all of that work, I think, was just presented in a way that was collaborative. You know, we outlined what we were looking for, what areas for feedback, and all of those pieces. I think another piece that actually kind of fostered a little bit of appreciation was, I think for the first time in several years, we were really thoughtful with that district-wide curriculum line and listened to teachers about the resources and materials that they were looking to have in their classroom and made purchases in line with that. I think you all heard a lot in the spring from the different departments about needs, whether it was textbooks or kits or whatnot, but I think for the first time we kind of took a big picture look at that line and spent the money in a way that it would have the best impact on kids.
I just think, I know we gave Justin a couple of pieces of feedback, right? But other than that, it's been probably one of the quieter starts that we've had in a long time. Now, we're 3 days.
I'm just going to say, what are you doing?
I'm leaving the country for 2 days in case you're looking for me. No, but if
I as just, am I.
It just seems as though that even if there was something, it seems as though we have a different infrastructure in place to respond, react. So that's just my...
I think communication is still someplace where we have some big hills to get up, but I definitely think the momentum and the goodwill, for lack of a better word, is there, so people are patient with us as we try to roll that piece out.
But internal, external, both communication?
All over. I think Sharon Monteforte, our communication specialist, started today. You know, obviously we would have loved to have her back in August, but we are excited about what she brings to the table and the future of communication here in Pembroke. But I think just there's a lot of new administrators here that, you know, aren't used to how we used to do things or aren't sure how we're going to do things. And so I think they've been hesitant to communicate in the sense that they don't want to over-communicate or make a mistake. So I think... that's probably the next kind of cultural piece that we'll try to tackle is the communication. But I do feel like the first 3 days of school the third day was boring. It's the building-based faculty meeting in your classroom kind of stuff. But even that, I went to, I happened to sit in the one at Havamok, and Danielle was, she had set up a staff notebook for the staff through OneNote, and it's the first time anybody had had kind of an interactive faculty meeting with them where they were all on their laptops. She was walking them through the handbook, how to put things, where she'd be making, notebook, I'm sorry, not handbook, where she'd be making changes, how to look for updates and that kind of piece. So even the energy for something that would be kind of mundane was there, and that was good to feel. So.
I was going to say, I also think, though, too, and it's to your credit, Erin, that staff are starting to see progress, right? Like we're
it's
saying,
slow,
right? No, but it's happening, right? And I think when you say you're going to do something and then you start to do it, and then the staff actually sees it. I mean, even the technology piece, it's not where we want it to be. It's not where we necessarily hope it, but we're making progress. And I think anytime teachers see that and they're involved in that progress, I mean, you get that energy, and I think we're starting to feel it and see it.
I think the commitment and the follow-through is huge. So,
better too.
We're on technology. Can you give a quick update on where we are?
Sure.
In terms of the changes?
If you don't mind, I'll just talk about it.
Yeah, I was going to say.
So you guys have seen this document that says focus areas, and it's not goals. These are goal areas, understanding that these are three of the topics where I've started to draft goals around that I'll kind of circulate to you, and I would like to talk about at our next meeting together if we can, because I would like for my goals to feed the principal goals, to feed school improvement plans, and it to feel cohesive, and I don't think it's felt that way for a while now, so that's where we'd like to get. But there were the three focus areas that we identified. The first one was achievement. The work over the summer, we split up into groups, so the achievement group identified what kind of their focus for the year would be. So developing a transparent and user-friendly curriculum maps. Understanding we have these, they're just not in a place where they're easy to find. This is another piece of that communication stuff. A lot of this stuff exists, it's just getting it into the hands of the people. We often have parents asking for them, where can we find them on the website, those kind of pieces. And we've talked a lot at this table and at some of the smaller subsets of this table about RTI and our commitment to that process.
What's RTI again?
Response to intervention. So, you know, in talking about what kind of in-classroom supports do we have for kids as far as reading and math and kind of remediating it, and what does a tier one support look like, what is tier two, what is tier three, and making sure that that's consistent throughout the buildings and that students and staff have access to the same resources. And then finally promoting a growth mindset, which is our goal in everything. But, the second area that we talk often about is social emotional health and wellness, so that is a no-brainer for a focus area. Again, one of the first pieces is kind of an inventory, right? Creating resources and increasing our ability to identify students. So kind of building a toolbox for teachers, whether it's materials or strategies, using professional development in those pieces, using consistent practices and common resources, making sure that students in all of our buildings have access to the same level of support, that we've articulated what our programs and supports are. And then back to the tier one and tier two interventions. I think every building uses the word tier one and tier two, but they mean different things in each building. So what are we remediating in the classroom? What are we sending a kid out for? That kind of stuff. And finally, technology.
Before you get into technology, is there a way to tie in the school resource officer into the second, the social, emotional,
yeah,
health and wellness section? Just because I know we're talking about that in October, but I think if it's going to be a focus here, we're going to tie everybody's goals into it.
Yep, I absolutely think that could fall into that first one.
At least Donna and Mark's, right? Mm-hmm. I think they should have some type of measure.
It will definitely fall into creating resources.
I think as we look in this year and we get the resource, we want to make sure we use it effectively, because when we get to spring town meeting and we try to get funding for it, I think we owe the town a report back on how effective it's been.
And so each of these, you know, 1, 2, 3 sub-bullets all have a work plan associated with them,
yep,
with more concrete initiatives, timelines, and people identified for.
Fair enough.
That, which is, I think, a big step for us. I don't think we've ever gotten to that level in anything before. As far as technology, our first goal is, goal area, was providing consistent, reliable, and equitable access to technology. So if it's okay with you, Paul, I'll just kind of update on them each at a time. So I think what we had talked about over the summer was
predictable. You didn't ask the question I was going to.
Well, what our efforts were over the summer was that reliable connection piece. And I think we've said oftentimes that we're wireless, but what is, yes, one person can pick up a signal throughout the high school, but can a classroom of students get on a device and interact with the teacher asking them to do? So we spent a lot of time this summer auditing that connection. And I think at the elementary level is where it's probably the only place where I made a significant investment. We had originally, when we talked about making the elementary schools wireless, talked about classroom sharing and access points, and that doesn't work. So just for two reasons. First of all, the number of devices we're trying to get on that one point is a very slow connection. And second, the construction of the buildings is solid cement walls. So we have a really hard time sharing the connection. So we did have some hotspots that we had purchased out of last fiscal year. And those hotspots are currently being installed at the elementary level so that each classroom has a hotspot. So our vision of RTI and having students on the Lexia program that we had presented to you back in the spring, it's truly possible. We didn't want to roll that out until we were sure that people were going to have a reliable connection at the elementary level. So K-6, we're able to get every classroom on an access point with access. There's still some pieces at the high school that I think we're talking about. I think as a building, the cafeteria and the gymnasium are not wireless. So I think that's next on our list. It's not a huge capital item, but it's something we use out of our operating budget. I'm not sure during the process why that didn't happen, but I think it makes sense. I think some of the content that's being delivered as part of the wellness piece of the curriculum,
yeah,
it's important for students to have access in the gymnasium and the cafeteria. Impacting student growth and achievement through the integration.
One second on the access part. So one of the concerns had been the firewall and the restriction of access to certain sites and things.
Sorry, yes, the firewall. We did a lot of work, and when I say we, I mean Mary Beth and myself. It was a labor of love to go through what the restrictions were. And so, she's laughing.
She's shaking her head.
So if you'll remember, I think 4 years ago when we rolled out BYOD for the first time, it was truly BYOD and people had access and could get on things, and that was the best experience people had had with wireless here. So we wanted to get back to a place where that was what it felt like for everybody. And so after much conversation, we are in a place where the content filters allow the access to look like that. So right now the content filters for students and staff on our wireless network as well as our wired network are the same. So that was a huge step. That's definitely going to better the experience on both ends, and it's an instant, so an easy win. That was, you know, didn't cost anything. It was just sitting down and kind of hammering through it.
It is very hot in here. I just want to be careful how I ask the question, to be honest with you. Have we philosophically aligned our access strategy across the district and across the administrators in the district?
Philosophically aligned.
Does that seem to be a stumbling point?
I think we're in the process. I think we're still working on what is, where do we want to be in 3 to 5 years, and working backwards from that. I think it was really important to get the teacher voice into that, and we're just now starting to do that. I think administratively we've talked about technology and what the resources look like in each building and how do we kind of remedy it so everyone has the same experience. I think philosophically we're still working on the teacher piece of that.
So based on the fact that you and Mary Beth looked at the content filters, it shows that at least your vision is known by the district because of what you allowed and didn't allow.
Yeah, it was actually some of it turned out to be not even as complicated as we thought. The filter, the Sophos filter, it has a check, there are check boxes for all the things that are blocked, right? Yeah. So there's a thing called uncategorized, and uncategorized is everything, like almost everything we need. Like it's like, so a lot of stuff was going in there.
Power Square, Edmodo.
So it was very simple win, because Sophos hadn't reviewed it yet, even though it was okay in other categories. It was passing the test for internet security. Our firewall is much better than that, so it was needed to take a second look at it. And what Paul did a lot of research on it, and what he discovered was that other districts had unclicked it, and by unclicking it, I haven't heard one complaint yet. And
but so you're also looking at what sites are being hit, because I'm sure there's things that are uncharacterized.
Correct.
Uncategorized.
So the checklist kind of filters all those out. So porn, vacation, all of that stuff.
Yeah, there's other stuff
in
there.
And so we started to look at, I think, the part where it started to become an issue for me was when we were talking about 21st century schools at the middle school, trying to teach the kids to figure out if they could afford a car loan, and everything with a loan calculator in it would be blocked.
I absolutely get you want to try and get, but then there are going to be one-off sites that you just have to watch to see what's being hit.
Yep.
Just to make sure that what's getting in the uncategorized category isn't something that you legitimately want to block.
Keep in mind that it's still the blocks are still there for the heavy hitter stuff. So there's still a block on porn. There's still a block on purchasing alcohol, purchasing drugs. You know,
I would expect that at DraftKings. Yeah, but then every so often new sites will come up that don't make that filter, right?
That's true.
So I just want to make sure we're protecting ourselves that way. Because now I'm kind of going to take that into one other area, because when we talk about PPS is committed to, the one thing I don't see is data protection. So we have a lot of data. Everything we've talked about is going out of our network or connecting to our network. But we're not talking about people trying to penetrate in.
We've spent a lot of energy and focus on security in the past couple of years, and I think that has become almost our stumbling block at times.
It's a lot easier to explain why you can't have a site than it is to say that we had a data breach.
There's absolutely still a process. There's absolutely...
I just want to make sure we make that clear, that it's a vision, and we're making a continued and concerted effort to make sure. Because the data we have, whether you look at the stuff that I just talked about at the beginning with some of the IP information that's housed, whether you're talking about even something as simple as grades.
Is PowerSchool hosted here, or is it...
Service.
It's a service, so we don't have that server here.
So then that should be in the contract with them.
It is. So the only servers that we have on site, I think, are our financial software, which is important. I even think Sims Tracker is
web-based, so no, yeah. It's not. Yeah.
There's only a handful of things that we own here, but absolutely understand what you're saying about continuing with the same levels.
Yeah, you start having, when you start using some of the other sites, and whether you call it Google Drive or whatever, yeah, that expose you, and you can't control what somebody puts there. Right? It's just things, and they're great tools used correctly.
Agreed.
Right? So.
So the other piece is impacting student growth and achievement through the integration of technology. And so this is still at the administrative level where we're starting to talk about tying in with the evaluation process and what are we looking for in terms of what is effective technology integration? You know, how is it used as a tool as opposed to just being a really expensive pencil? So all of that, I will come back to you. I think October is the meeting that you'll get the full tech plan. We'll have really detailed information about all of those.
We can do that in October.
Yes.
Oh, boy.
So with that being said, my hope is to get to a meeting schedule where if you continue to meet twice a month or even once a month, that each month you get some kind of presentation on one of these three topics, so that we're constantly checking in on where we are with these things, and it's kind of a really good check-in for us and informative for you guys so that you know where we're at with these things and it's not just something you're hearing in September and kind of fizzles out as the school year goes on.
Any other questions on the focus areas?
No, looks good. Okay. Thank you for the progress on the technology.
We're getting there. So let's get it.
D-E-F-H-R-I.
I like eeny, meeny, miny, D. So, you will remember back in the spring we had a lovely host family come to us about a student from Germany. Mm-hmm. We have a second year-long foreign exchange student looking for admission to the high school. This student, unlike the student from the spring, the host family has students at the high school. And so Cultural Homestead International is the organization that is sending the student. This is not one of the companies named in your policy, though the policy does say that you guys are open to recommendations from myself. So I did do a little bit of research on the company. I spoke with two principals, one in Quincy and one in Weymouth, that both had an exchange student from this program last year. They had nothing but great things to say about the level of detail, the follow-up, the contact pieces to it. This student in particular has supplied all of the required documentation, the immunization, the proof of English fluency, has been in contact with the guidance department, and we are ready to get her going with a full schedule as long as you are all on board.
Move to approve.
She is
Spain.
Spain. I missed that. I couldn't. Okay. I apologize, Paul. Go ahead.
So do we just need to approve it, or do we need to waive the policy and approve
I think
it?
You just have to approve it because the policy says that you're open to other companies okay. that are yes. named as long as I right. do right. due diligence. So
just for the record and for clarity, this in no way violates our school choice program or anything correct. Else. We're allowed to take on exchange students.
Your policy says program. Up to four a year, so this would be our second one for this year.
So move to accept the exchange student approved. Request or application of Maria Rodriguez Pazos.
So motion by Patrick, second by?
Oh, second it.
Paul?
I think it should be approved, though, rather than accept.
Oh, and I'll make it approved.
So motion approved?
Amendment.
Okay, so on the motion to approve, first of all, any other questions or comments?
Just a comment, could we ask policy to look at that and we maybe remove those two companies and just leave it up to the discretion of the superintendent?
Probably makes sense.
Mm-hmm. It seems like the last two that have come through.
Have
nothing
on
them?
Yeah.
Yeah,
he wants to reword it again.
I can tell you, I know the host family, and they're really, really good, really, really, really good people. They're Briggs Bryant, so Tyler Bryant, who graduated last year, his dad and stepmom, and they have twins who are 10th graders. Jared and Marissa, they're great kids. So any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Okay.
Just in the same lines of this, I actually did meet Paul Schultz last weekend.
Oh, yeah.
Went to his house, the house he's staying at, and met him. There was a kind of a welcome party for him. So he was
little shy, but I'm sure he'll get over that once he gets in school. But it was nice to meet him, and welcome him.
I'm glad you got to go. Thank you for being
yeah.
there.
Yeah, it was nice.
Moving weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So homeschool requests. This is becoming one of my least favorite things. So in your packet, we had kind of coordinated into an Excel spreadsheet last year, as well as you have the backup for any of the ones that are on for approval tonight that just show the building principal has reviewed the documents. This seems to be a moving target. They keep coming in. I think two more came in on Friday. Danielle at Hobmouth received one of the others that were missing here today. So my hope is that we will have an answer on all of the outstanding ones by your next meeting. We do have a couple of homeschooling families that are coming back this year. So I think so far there's four students that had traditionally been homeschooled that are coming back.
I know. Yeah.
Which is exciting.
So, as far as this goes, how do we approve these?
Can we just move all of them that are SC approval 9-6?
I think we have to go by family. Yeah, by family, by student.
Because, because of what you said, it has me. You said a couple more came in today. Are those so if we looked at all
of the ones that are not on here for school committee approval.
Got it. So anything here for 9-6 mm-hmm. are only the only ones you want approved?
Correct.
So mm-hmm. is there...
So I have a question, I guess. So Carolyn Milankiewicz is not approved, but her brother is?
That was going to be one of mine. Mm-hmm. That's why I think it was important to go by family, by student.
Because...
So it says tech
like
virtual.
She's doing something different.
She's doing, yeah, she is doing something
so
different. That's
why. So that's not... homeschooling, right? They unenroll.
Correct. This is actually DESE approved. TECA?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's online.
It's an online, but it's an approved private mm-hmm. school.
So then who, you guys review her progress throughout the year, or?
No, it's not. It's like enrolling in any private fair.
We have another TECA. So, is there a motion to approve the homeschooling request for Josiah Albee, Jack Albee, Natalie Albee, Alexa Al-Hadef? Did I get it right?
Sure.
Nicholas Al-Hadef. Is that Jacob Earl? Should it be? Or Jacket Earl?
It's the T.
Oh, it is the T. Okay. Alexander Edmondson, Michael Edmondson, Sydney Paul, and Joey Wolin-Gavitz.
So moved.
Second.
So motion by Patrick, second by Suzanne.
And we have the principals have reviewed everything. Everyone's on board with the curriculum.
Okay. All those in favor? Any further discussion?
Nope.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain. It's unanimous. Okay. Yeah. Virtual and Performing Arts co-curricular positions.
I thought you were waving.
Would it be smaller?
Well,
don't get Patrick going.
There's only a couple balls in the magnifying
glass. So you have in front of you our Visual and Performing Arts advisors. These were posted in May, pending budget approval, obviously. There were no reductions to these areas, so... Sure, I'm ready for questions and comments.
First of all, before Patrick asks his question,
sure.
Is there a motion to approve the visual and performing arts co-curricular positions for the school year 2016-2017?
Yes.
So motion by Ginny, second by?
Second.
Suzanne, thank you.
Three.
Is there any further comments from Patrick?
So, every year I bring this up, and I'm going to do it again. I struggle to understand on a couple of these what would appear to be a department's head responsibility, why we're paying a stipend for something that fits within the responsibilities of a department head. So that's my one question. And then the other, to me, I don't think a department head should be able to be stipended for these roles, because their job is to lead the department. And if we can't actually go and get the folks to do it, then the responsibility by default would fall back on them. I struggle with paying a stipend for that.
So first off, we do post each of them each year.
Yep.
And you'll, since you've been on the committee for several years, realize that the number of positions filled by a department head are fewer.
They are fewer. They're definitely fewer this year than ever before. I agree.
With that being said, the responsibilities associated with some of these are well beyond the scope of what we would ask a traditional department head to do. The number of night times, the number of meetings, and the logistic piece to it is much more than we'd be asking of a department head.
And it's any department head, by the way. I don't mean to single out this one.
Correct. So our process in general is that we don't set in administrators.
But, right.
I will remind you that our director of fine and performing arts also teaches three sections, which is not similar to how our other department heads are structured.
But it's part of the job and the job description that's out there for that role.
Correct. Right? But as we've kind of moved in a direction where the department heads are K through 12, they don't teach at all, whether it's math, science, social studies, or English. So she's the only one left that is teaching, and these roles are far beyond what would be asked of anybody in a content supervisor or traditional department head role.
So my opinion is always want to have the best person possible for the position. Mm-hmm. If this is the best, and it seems to be, I mean, if you go to the performances, right, you've seen the performances, it definitely, hear me out on mm-hmm. another thing, it seems to be the best person for the job. Mm-hmm. Rather than continue this discussion every year, if the job description is considerably different, is the job description changed, and this either baked into the job description and then brought into, you know,
so that's something we do in the when we're
that's probably a better solution.
That probably is a better and again, it has nothing to do with this one.
No, I understand that.
This is about just in general, an administrator and
no, I get it. I get it. And if I
that is right.
The part of that again, whether it was Gwen or whether it was anybody else,
Mary Beth,
we always want. Can you start teaching choir?
Yeah, sure.
We always want the best person for the job.
I totally agree.
Right, and you know, even if we had an administrator who was going into a coaching position, we would want to do the same thing. But what I would say is the same thing. Do you change the job description and then bring the stipend in?
But if Justin was going to coach, I wouldn't stipend him to do that either. That's my point.
I get what you're saying.
That's exactly my point, right? And I think when it's music, and to your point, that's fewer. It's happening at much fewer instances this year than I've ever seen.
If we think it's going to be ongoing, whether it's here or somebody else, we have to look at the process rather than just say a blanket no, because then we're hurting ourselves.
No, I agree. This is a conversation I have annually.
I'm trying to avoid this conversation next year.
No, I appreciate it. I'm with you.
Ability to voice this voice.
It's predictable.
Yeah.
Okay. We all are at this point. So, all those in favor?
Yes.
All those in favor?
Say aye.
Opposed? Abstain?
I'll say yes.
It's unanimous.
It's tough, but
good Lord.
Right. So discussion of annual town meeting articles.
Oh boy.
So we're going out of order again.
Are you hoping we pass out before the AP scores?
I want
scores?
Mary Beth to sweat for another 5 minutes before we talk about it.
She's cold.
Because the answer is
getting sick.
I have no idea.
Oh my God. I'm like,
is that one of the articles?
Air conditioning is the library address. I think traditionally, similar to what has happened in the past, the window of opening and closing of the town meeting warrant does not necessarily sync with our meeting schedule.
And I think I'm going to abstain from this conversation.
So,
mention that it's a little short, right?
Yeah.
It's like a week. 10 days. So we had talked last year as part of long-range planning about having kind of a recurring capital conversation. In speaking with Town Administrator Ed Thorne, our capital request would be part of the larger town meeting article, so that wasn't something we needed to take an action on at the time for the warrant that was open. What we did do was place a placeholder in the warrant so that we would be able to continue our replacement of turf and track discussion. I think there's different sentiments amongst the group on where we are with that. I think we had all hoped and thought that we would be talking about this for next fall town meeting with the summer of 2018 replacement, but I think having Justin on board, who has some extensive turf knowledge, that the conversation has kind of, the timeline has sped up a little bit. I do think there is some ability within our own operating budget to talk about some of these pieces. So just want to talk about next steps on whether we're kicking this back to long-range planning or how you want the information to come to you, because there's definitely some information gathering that needs to happen before you guys are in a place.
We don't have a lot of time, right? Because we're talking about celebrating in October for the fall town meeting, so I think we need to get the data to the committee as fast as possible.
But can I ask, if it's coming out of operating budget, is that a budget conversation?
Has to go to town meeting if it's a borrow, unless it's some type of...
Well, but if you're paying it back, like we did the lights through the budget...
That's still to go to town meeting.
No,
we would discuss it in budget.
Would you say, hey, we have that capability of supporting X number?
Can I just, up until about, I don't know, 3 weeks ago, I think you would have sold me on replacing the turf field. At some point, maybe not this year.
No.
However, uh-oh. I don't know if anybody happened to see, was it Sharon? There was a town, I don't even remember the league. But there was a town that actually put all the coaches on administrative leave because they, during one of the hot summer days.
It was Westwood.
Was it?
No, Framingham.
Whatever it was, it was somewhere Metro West.
Framingham.
Had a number of players who got burned because the turf gets hot.
Yes.
And it is, I mean, everybody knows the turf gets hotter, and especially with, because of the tire elements. Before we consider turf, I think we should look at pros and cons of turf versus grass.
I see what you're saying. I think the field has to be replaced.
But here's my issue. I'm not advocating for either at this point. I'm just saying, based upon that,
the fact that we
need to make sure, because players got hand burns because the turf got so hot.
So based on your comment, I'd like to answer Aaron's question. I think it goes to long-range planning.
Long-range planning, okay.
That's my opinion. Because of what you just said, it's a little bit more in-depth. It's not just about the money. It's about pros and cons.
It's what works long-term.
But I think you could get a recommendation from Justin and fairly quickly whether it should be grass or turf.
So I think there's a larger piece to that discussion that Justin is not going to have the history on. So the fact that the entire high school complex drains through one drain, mm-hmm. the fact that there's been extensive water drainage work done by the DPW behind the high school this past summer. And I think when we had talked about this before, we were always knowing that the timeline was give or take a year or two. We were always hesitant to make a move before that drainage situation was figured out in the back.
Grass could cost more because you're going to have to sink a well.
And
ideally at that point you're going to sink a well and you're going to try and move it for the back corner so you can do the practice fields as well to give you additional fields, whatever it is.
Yep.
The bottom line is you're going to, whatever we do next, it has to be thoughtful and it has to be right.
Which is why it should be a long-range plan.
We will make the best decision we can with the knowledge we have at that time.
I agree.
Things change, unfortunately.
Is there any reason we have to do it this fall and we couldn't do it if we're doing it out of our own budget? Why we couldn't?
You're paying for the bond out of the budget, that's all.
So, selectmen to approve any, you can enter into a lease purchase that's longer than 3 years, so they'd have to approve that borrowing. And I honestly, the price point for irrigation in a grass field, I don't even have any parameters on
it. Yeah, and I'm not advocating for it. I'm just saying, if we're gonna spend this or consider spending this amount of money, we need to have the information in front of us.
That's absolutely right.
Also the track, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Because is there anything to say we couldn't do it in a special in the spring that would allow us to...
But it's a borrowing.
I think doing it now is really good planning because it gives us the latitude to be able to do it in multiple seasons.
It also, the timing of it, so if you're looking for a summer replacement, we have to do an RFP, post and bid it out and get proposals and...
Better set.
Because you're late May, right?
You can still bid it before you go to town meeting, though.
I think though, but Mike,
if you do it in a special, you can spend the money at the time of the special versus waiting for an annual, which doesn't come forth until July 1st, which would put you under the gun for whatever project it is to maybe not finish by the time you start football's tryouts.
Why wouldn't we put the placeholder up, have the placeholder on, and see if we can get the data, so we can make a rational, informed, data-driven decision, then we move forward and we do it. If we can't, then we just pull the article.
That's fine.
Because I agree with you about getting the right due diligence. It's a lot of money.
If you try to do it at the last minute, you're going to get
We're not at the last minute yet.
But.
All right, let's go forward now then.
Yep.
And not wait.
When's the town meeting?
October 22nd. Somewhere around there.
25, maybe. 23? 23.
Is it a calendar in that right corner? It is too. It's right there. Just click on that.
I have administrative authority on my calendar.
25th.
25.
Okay.
Aye, aye, aye.
Just gained a few more days there.
Okay.
Yep.
So, moving on to number H, discussion of AP scores.
Mary Beth, all of the information...
You have 5 minutes before we dehydrate and die.
...is in your packet, but I just, for the sake of the audience, asked Mary Beth to make a couple of visual...
And you, I have no idea why, how you guys with long sleeves are even like managing.
I'm not. I feel like I'm going to pass out.
We don't have any waters in here, do we?
No, we're not doing any water.
It's not in the budget.
Stay longer.
I'm good.
Smile. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, do we have to send this
pamphlet, Aaron? Yeah, Aaron should send it. Or I think we get it in the spring or another. You have mine too, don't you?
Yeah, I have mine.
Yeah, I had them both there. So.
I'm going to give it a night off.
This is a chart that has everything else.
Oh, I really can't read that. These aren't going to help me either.
Does Facebook make it through the firewall?
It does, yep.
It's because we clicked on categorize.
For admin.
you just got excited about that.
Wow. I don't know that, but that's how it
She's
used
awake.
To be.
She's awake.
I'll find it. It's on you on the chart thing. Can you just give it in a nutshell?
I read through the documents. What? What happened?
It's a test.
Apparently.
Oh,
disaster. That's terrible. Wow. Who planned that?
I had to work this morning, that's why.
You had no choice.
I did it after being out sick.
Yeah, that's right.
I had to go back on antibiotics.
Are you all back tomorrow?
Yeah, I just finished up.
Why'd you go back?
I came back after I went up 2 weeks.
Did you meet
again? I went off a week and I came back.
Mm-hmm.
So I was back on for 3 weeks.
Mike, when is our next meeting?
We're going to talk about that.
Trying to do it while we're ready to bend this up?
Sure. Do we want to? We need another meeting.
Can I help?
We need another meeting in September because we have to talk about the electronic signature, get a update on the private school, talk about Erin's goals as she talked about, and I think we need at least a follow-up or check-in on the fall town meeting, and we have to certify the detailed budget. It should be relatively short. Does 2 weeks from tonight, the 20th, work? And then after that, we can talk in at that meeting too about potentially going to one business meeting a month.
Yeah.
It has to be really, really short. I got to be out by 8 on Tuesday, the 20th.
Can we start at 7?
I probably cannot.
Well,
so
I'll just stay.
No.
There's things I'm interested in, I'll just request that they're early and then I'll have to leave.
Do you have to leave, do you have to be somewhere at 8 or do you have to leave at 8?
I can be flexible.
You sure?
Yeah.
That's, I can do the 20th.
I can do the 20th.
Okay. Actually,
I just can't stay here until 10. I can't stay late that night. Nope, even with air conditioning, cannot.
So 7:30 or 7 o'clock?
So can we, let's compromise, let's go 7:15.
7?
That totally threw me off.
That's good.
Or am I just
okay. That'll give us a little
thank
bit.
Thank you.
Yep. And we will have a tight agenda and we will go. So Mary Beth, why don't you?
Okay, so first let me just front load a little bit. So what you have in your packet and what I had shared with you through email when they came out was the AP scores. This is traditionally something that we bring to you as part of the achievement report, which I would anticipate being kind of a November-ish timeline, but understanding that this information is time sensitive, and if we want to make a change and propose some things for the upcoming year, the earlier we get it to you, the better. So Mary Beth is just going to highlight some of the pieces, so our five-year overview, some of the specific tests, and just some of the changes that we made for this current year and some areas that we're looking at for next year.
So you have all this information that you're going to see tonight. So I just wanted to pull out a few highlights for you so that you could sort of celebrate with us some of the achievements that we've had this year and also be made aware of some of the areas where we want to continue to grow and to strengthen the program. You can see on this slide, one of the nice things about this slide is that our the number of AP students who are receiving a 3 at Pembroke High School is at the same level as the state for 2016 there. So it's kind of a nice, sort of kind of a little bit of growth that you can see in that slide. And as we go through what you're seeing in front of you, one of the things that's important for us to note when we go through this is we have a relatively, what we call an open program, which doesn't mean that anybody can walk through the door and take the class, but that we encourage students to try as best they can to always be taking a class that's a little bit harder, a little bit more rigorous, something that will help them long-term to develop the skills that will help them to be successful after they leave us. So what you see on the blue line there is AP language and composition, and I picked one from each discipline. I tried to pick one that has a large number of students. So there are 49 students that sat last year. This is a junior class. And it's recommended by the College Board and by some of the other organizations that dabble in the AP world as one of the gateway courses. They think this is a very important course for juniors to take, and it has correlations with like statistics, calculus. It's kind of interesting. So this is a highly recommended course. And one of the things that I just wanted you to take a look at is we have a tool that the College Board promotes called AP Potential. So based on students' PSAT scores, AP Potential, which is a College Board metric that they put together, is it, you can pick a cut score. So you can say, I want to know every student in my school who has a 50% chance of getting a 3, who has a 60% chance of getting a 3 or better, who has a 70% chance of getting a 3 or better. What that does is we don't use that information to rule students out, but what we try to use that information for is to make sure we're pulling the right students in. And also it does help us if we have a student who's stretching and say they're below that qualifying or below that AP potential number and say they're trying to take 3 classes. It gives us another data point to say, we want you to stretch, we want you to try an AP course, let's start with 1. Let's not start with 3. So it gives us some information. But one of the things that I think that's interesting is that you can see that there were 35 students that were identified as having AP potential, and then there were 14 who were not. And those numbers look really, really good for a group of students. The 14 students that were not identified, 10 of those 14 qualified. That is, they got a score of 3 or better. So it's kind of a nice piece to that story. In addition to, you can see that there's a bit of a bump there in terms of the relative to the state, how Pembroke did it compared to the state. AP Chemistry. Another interesting story, all of the students that were identified with AP potential received qualifying scores, and of the 11 students that took the class, which means more students took the class that were not identified at that 60% point, of those 11 students, 9 of those students qualified. So that's a very positive piece of information.
The other positive thing that I found in the AP chemistry were the number of kids who got 4s and 5s. I know it's a topic. Absolutely. I talked about last year.
Yep.
It went from 3 in 15 to 8 in 16.
Yep.
It was a nice improvement on the top end as well.
Yep.
I mean, that score jumped pretty well, and it's significantly above, average is significantly above Massachusetts.
Yep.
I like looking at it this way. I know you're going to get to the mean chart, I'm sure, which is a little...
I know, it gets a little kooky, yeah.
Right, because this is actually, you're talking about actual students and actual scores and actually what they can do with it. It's real.
Yeah. So I think that's, anyways, this is a class that has had success for a while. This is an interesting class. AP Psychology is one of our classes that a lot of students take for the first time they ever take an AP class. And again, some nice numbers there for the students, not only who were identified as students who would be successful, but also for students. You can see of the 39 students that were not identified, 22 of those 39 received qualifying scores. That's a positive aspect of the program. We're saying that we want kids to stretch, we want kids to try, mm-hmm. and those students are having success. And that's, you know, hopefully that's what we're going for.
But I think what it also tells me is that the kids who didn't qualify or don't have an AP potential, aren't identified as AP potential, somehow the instruction reached them in 2016 that didn't reach them in 2000, you know, obviously different groups, different students, but somehow.
Right, so it's different groups, right?
Different
groups.
We're
always trying to tease out what's the magic formula? Is it instruction? Is it curriculum? Is it the students in front of us?
But if you look we reversed a downward trend. I mean, trends can be evaluated or looked at, and it was reversed. I think it's a great improvement.
Yeah. Another sort of area of impact where we had 12 students who were not identified, and half of those 12 students qualified in AP statistics. Mm-hmm. The numbers last year were a little bit smaller than usual, and I just wanted to let you know that this year they're at 60 for AP statistics.
Wow.
Yeah. So there's...
What I think is really interesting, and I think this really shows it, is the slope of the lines should be reasonably the same because it shows the difficulty of the test that year and what have you, right? So for example, between 14 and 15, you have a downward trend here in Pembroke, but you also had it with the state and then to a smaller degree globally.
Yep.
There may have been something about that test in 2015, right?
Yep.
That actually creates that, and you want to sort of see those similarities. Now, the fact that we had such a large jump between 13 and 14 may be programmatic to your point. I don't know what the magic sauce is there, but the correlation of those lines, I think, is really important for us to understand, and then where we are above or below the Massachusetts global lines.
So this is just, these are the mean scores that Suzanne was talking about that, you know, take them for what they're worth. Certainly every AP teacher I know takes them to heart. So even though, you know, we kind of sit here and say it's about the individual students, those teachers are vested heavily in the performance of students, and, you know, they want to make sure that they're providing the right curriculum and the right instruction to meet them where they're at. You can see the number of qualifying scores there. The percent who earned a three or better. But one of the things I also was looking at this year, and it's, again, this is not, I don't have enough data to make global sort of sweeping comments, but I'm just interested when we have classes, when, for example, if you take a look at United States government, the percentage of students who earned a three or better was 25%, but only 23% of the students that enrolled in the class were identified as likely to be successful in the class.
Hmm.
So that's, if 23% are identified, you can do the math, right? What's the flip side of that is that the majority of the students that were sitting in that class had not been identified. Therefore, the gaps may have been greater for those particular students. Now, it's a very popular class. So we want to try to see, you know, how we can work, you know, with that curriculum and with that teacher who's absolutely wonderful and, you know, willing and happy to do anything he can. So how do we work with that group so that we can start to see a little bit more of a success there in terms of if we're using qualifying scores as a factor in success. And I'm not sure, you know, when you have an open program like that you can always just use that as your metric for success.
That's one data point.
Right.
The reverse is the case with Euro, right? where 63% of the kids were identified as being, as having potential to have success, but only 25% earned a qualifying score.
Right.
And there were eight kids.
That's exactly to Sue's point, why I think the other sides are so much more powerful.
Exactly.
I think the question that comes to my mind is, how do we get more kids to be AP potential?
I think that's the right question.
That's kind of like pulling it further down.
That is the right question.
You know, pulling it down further into the grades to what makes somebody AP potential? Because I know it's based upon the PSAT scores, and not everything here is tested on PSAT.
Right.
That's why we have the NAs, but some of them are extrapolated, like statistics, they're basing it upon math scores, which really haven't been taught statistics yet.
Yeah. Right.
So I just think this.
But I think that's the right question. And how do we, you know, just like we're always trying to create entry points for kids to join more accelerated classes or to move ahead so they can take these AP courses by the time they're at the end of their senior year, thinking about how we can enrich the curriculum K through 6, 7, and 8 so that we have more kids that are better able to enter AP classes is exactly what we want to be focusing on. Because I think this is, you know, a lot of this data is pretty good.
So 200 kids out of, what, 500? So 200 kids on the first page of the...
You had 199 kids.
199 kids.
There were 400 tests.
Took 400 tests. So 200 out of... And they're all juniors and seniors. Predominantly, I don't know what...
Correct.
The, more seniors.
Mostly. There's every now and then we have a sophomore who's really like some sort of prodigy that, you know, moves ahead. But
how does that compare percentage-wise of participation versus other districts? Do we know?
We show up in the sort of in that AP equity and excellence chart as a percentage of seniors who have earned qualifying scores. I think we're at like 30 something, and compared to other districts, where it seems like we're never in like the top 10%, but we're right there, right just after it. So I have to get more better data for you on that. We're not hitting that like, you know, like golden apple area.
But that's the qualifying scores. I'm thinking just in terms of we're looking at participation.
Participation.
If we ask Mark what was his participation at Duxbury for seniors.
Yeah.
Are we getting more kids to take the test?
Yeah. When we look at the DART scores, yes. Like when we look at our DART areas, but I don't know in terms of the entire country, in terms of the College Board. So the College Board gives out an award for that, an AP participation award. Mm-hmm. And Duxbury's received it. Hingham, I think, has received it. But I'm not sure.
We were also recognized there by that with that North American award. We were one of, I can't remember how many districts.
Years ago.
400 or something. Yeah. No, for AP.
Excellent.
This is, a couple of years ago for that exact thing, participation.
It would help to see if you took, you know, the number of students at 11th grade or 12th grade taking an AP class, compared that to the other districts.
Yeah, and I think I have that data.
I think that would be the metric, because then you're not having to worry about number of classes, whatever. But I want to compare it against schools that have open enrollment.
Correct.
Right.
And that's where it gets a little trickier. It takes a lot more work to get at that, because you can say you're open enrollment, and you're still 15 hoops you jump through to get into the class. So you have to really tease it out a little bit and get to know the people that are there so you have a better sense of what's going on.
So you gave an update on the 2015 recommendations, which I think everybody can look at.
So I just want to say one thing, though, before we move on. Next year, this is kind of a nice piece of information. There are 270 students enrolled for this year to take exams in 2017, and that represents 490 tests that we'll have. That's a nice, a big bump.
Yep.
It's a big class.
It's a big class, but it's also, I'll tell you, there's a chunk of AP computer science. That's where the biggest bump is. There's 53 kids signed up to take computer science, the Java one, and computer science principles together is 53 kids. That's a chunk.
It's great. It's great that we have the opportunity and we're offering the class, but then we also allowing that many students to take it. I think that's great, because one of the things, again, you don't want to revisit everything, but we always got looked at, would we have AP opportunities for students if we were our own district? And that's clearly not an issue, you know,
have made it a commitment and made it happen, and appreciated by the community.
It's been a priority because we see the value of it beyond just getting out of the class, right, or not taking the class, able to go into advanced.
I've looked at some of the private schools, and I think we offer more courses than a lot of the private schools.
Oh yeah,
yeah, especially the same size.
Yeah,
I don't think that's a question anymore.
Well, I think we've done even with some of the smaller courses, which tend to be in the language areas, where that's an elective, and then to get to that level is so rigorous that we've kept them.
Euro with eight.
which is up this year. Euro is up to 21, so.
Well, I guess we're trying to go with the 2015. I get what I'd like to see is what else, because you know, and you have the 2016 here, but when you talked about getting more to AP potential, what does that plan look like?
So how do we move more of our K through 8 students to a position where they're able to take those courses? I think we're doing it. I think, you know, when you institute a new math program that focuses on higher order thinking and conceptual thinking, K through 6, there's your step right there. Mm-hmm. So I think some of the things are in place to go. Like that's going to be positive. I also feel like the new science, the interactive science program, which we've purchased from Pearson, is another area that's going to help students to begin to develop those critical thinking skills and that metacognition piece much earlier, because both those programs focus on students being able to explain why they're doing what they're doing, so that teachers can then make those corrections as they're learning. So, and not that that's, you know, that's certainly not rocket science. Teachers have been doing that for a long time, but they've actually institutionalized it into a process in their program. The other area that I'd like to see us moving in, but we have to really take some of these things a little slowly. Our K through 6 teachers are really inundated right now. They have a new math program and a new science program. They have 3 new benchmark assessments in social studies with an ELA focus. So there's a lot that's coming at them. But I would think that our next area of focus will be on writing. And what kind of a writing program, to your point, the better we get with students being able to write, the better they're going to do all the way through. So that's got to be another focus area for us once things start to settle and people are confident and, you know, comfortable with the tools they have right now. I would go that. So that would be my next area, Mike, in terms of that.
Mary Beth, I don't, and I'm probably just jumping all over the place.
That's okay.
I'll apologize ahead of time, but
there's like
a couple, you know, we have, and I don't want to take away from the success stories, because the success stories in this packet far outweigh the challenges, right? I mean, I want to be clear, but there's a couple kind of glaring areas where it's been year after year after year where we struggle. Latin, US Gov, physics. What do we do? Like, is it a development issue? Is it a curriculum issue?
It's all of those. Okay, yeah. So what we want to do is obviously make sure that we have enough people trained to deliver AP curriculum, so that if we have 2 sections, maybe we can have 2 teachers working in that area. We have a situation where 2 teachers in science are going to be retiring pretty soon. They decided that, you know, with some discussion in the department, physics and AP chemistry now will have new teachers this year, mm-hmm. with the benefit of having on site the teachers that used to teach that course.
Yeah.
We added a US history teacher last year to the curriculum, and there's also she's new but not really new to AP. Mm-hmm. Lynn Place will be working with the AP US, now it's gonna be 1 year. So Lynn Place has moved into that role in the junior year. So we're just, you know, sort of, some of it is about trying to match people where they're at and where their skills
are. Where their strengths are.
Yep. Some of it has to do with, you know, the AP changes its curriculum. They've changed their curriculum a couple of times. The calculus test is under redesign. There'll be a new test in 2017. We've already got, you know, we already know that there are 2-day and 1-day institutes that we want our teachers to be able to attend, so.
Is there anything that you need from us to help you do that? Or is there anything as we're thinking of the 2018
No, I think you guys are doing, in terms of support, I feel like the AP program is very supported. And I think the AP Extra Help, although I can't draw any hard and fast data conclusions from that, it doesn't really prove anything. Mm-hmm. Anecdotally, I can tell you that teachers will say to me, being able to sit with students one-on-one, even if it's 1 or 2 students, 3 students that they're able to capture in those small groups, has made a difference.
Okay.
And I have to trust that's for sure. And I know that in some cases, for example, like in AP Chemistry, you know, Cheryl Porter, she took the amount of money that we allotted, but she put in, you know, 10 more Saturdays than the Saturdays that she offered. So does that extra help matter? I do think it matters. So that kind of support.
Okay.
And I also think if you're going to say that, I think one of the things that the teachers worry about and take to heart is that, oh, you know, if the scores aren't high, people will be mad. Well, I think that we want to be really clear that our philosophy is about encouraging growth. It's about bringing students in, right?
I guess I would call it a qualified high. If you had, you know, a high number of AP potential, but then the scores were low, would want to look to see if there was
There's the disconnect.
Which is why I kind of looked at it.
But for the most part, as long as we're open on enrollment, I think there has to be an expectation that the mean score is going to be potentially lower.
Right, which does not, that score doesn't, that what that score doesn't capture is your student growth, right? It's not capturing what the impact of that course is on the student then or in a latent situation.
I'll be honest, I would much rather see a lower mean score and then see 39 non-qualifying kids that took the test and 22 of them qualify with the score. To me, that is so much better for kids than being able to go around and saying, hey, our mean score is a 3.5, but I only have 12 kids taking it.
Right.
Because we're, like, all of the studies show, and we've talked about this ad nauseum, if you take an AP course in high school, you do better in college.
I challenge that study. There's a lot of literature challenging that. The only people who have funded that study was the college board.
Well, Dell. Dell and actually Dell and Gates were involved in that too. But they're all supportive of the college board and what the college board is doing.
Yeah, there's definitely some studies that say that's not necessarily.
But intuitively, whether or not the data can support it, Paul, there's no question that having to read a college textbook.
I'm not disputing. I just don't like the idea that
being
relied on that study.
That's just one study, though. It's what the kids learn, the discipline that they learn, what they have to go through, the rigor. It literally prepares them early, I think, to move on in the academic rigor of university. And I think, or I believe very strongly, actually, that our open enrollment program benefits a heck of a lot more kids than one mean score.
So, you're saying it a different way. You can't rely on just one piece of data to make the decision. And if you disagree with whether that study is right or not, what you have to look is what you're exposing the student to before they get into college. You also have to look at the value of the student taking that class on the college application process, right? Because they're looking for the student to challenge themselves. Now, you don't want them to challenge themselves and have first term grade be an F or a D, but you also want to make sure that, you know, you're giving the support so it doesn't happen. But I guess my point is, when you look at the total package, and I know, because Patrick, I'm just like you, I hone in on that one piece, but I know it's the whole picture, it's the whole package.
Yep, no doubt.
So, and I think
that's why
we all have different reasons for it, or different reasons why we support it, but I think collectively, it's the right decision.
Right, I think so.
100% support the open. Yeah. And I think you guys have done a great job in terms of having the conversations about multiple AP courses, because I think that's sometimes where...
And that's really fallen on guidance. So you can just see that those are the things that we identified last year, the parent night, the contract, the meetings, and to, you know, in some way to adjust the course selection process so parents were a little bit more involved, or at least understanding. Like, I think you had even mentioned, Paul, that your daughter was recommended for a number of different courses. You didn't even really know, right? I mean, the teacher, you didn't have a lot of communication on that. I do think providing the extra help, I'd like to see teachers feel empowered to start that a little earlier. The cost of it was like $3,000 for the year.
Yep.
I think it's well worth it to do that. There are, you know, the content-specific things, eliminating the pre-AP, that's all got done. The ads, obviously, and then content-specific training that happened this summer is all listed there.
So we won't see for the U.S. history one, we won't see the results of that for another year, because the kids who are taking it this year took AP as sophomores.
That's right.
Correct.
So the true recalibration that would have happened before 11th won't happen until...
Yeah, that's also a test that had adjustments, too.
But I think, I mean, actually, I'd have to point out that U.S. history is being one of the ones that made some great progress this year in terms of overall average score, as well as the people who are getting, I mean, last year was 0 fives, and this year was 4 fives, and, you know, 15 fours. I mean, I think it was a great moving up the scale for the same number of students.
There's some really, really good pockets of growth, student growth and achievement that are happening out there. For 2016, there's a new program that the College Board is hawking right now.
AP Insight.
AP Insight. It's not a lot of money. It's about $1,000 for our largest course for biology. But I want to look at it first and see if it's something that we need, or if it's even appropriate. It's supposed to be like they're calling it a roadmap. I had to send away for information. Someone's going to contact me, but
so a salesperson's going
So it's like $400 for the course, but you're supposed to get like if you got a test bank out of it alone, that's like something that you could work with. That might be helpful. They said that there's some scoring that goes on. It's all kinds of video presentation to train, and it's supposed to be a roadmap to success for the teacher to work for working with students. So I'd like to see how that's packaged before we make a commitment to it, but it sounds like something that might be of interest. If we could find one teacher who was interested in piloting it, that might be a worthwhile endeavor to see if it's worth it. One of the things, to your point about Latin and some of the persistent difficulties in Latin, it could be the fact that there's no Latin 2 or French 2 honors course.
Yep.
And that's, I think in some ways was driven by budgetary considerations for some years and the size of the programs and adding yet another prep into the mix for teachers. As it is, the foreign language teachers, most of them do 4 or almost 5 preps, which is, you're starting to get into kind of a lot of different levels of instruction. So that's something that we're going to, take a look at this year. Christine Nugier, who's been working there as a supervisor for the department, has some data on that and some information on that. I think that would be interesting to look at. History and math, there's going to be the 2-day institutes. We want to send our teachers who have been teaching for a while to do a little bit of some training. They're excited to do that. They love doing that. So that would be a good thing. And then the last sort of area is sort of going to be a team effort. But as we talk about extending the school day and adding more time to the school day, being thoughtful about how that time is used. Is that being used to enrich and support? How is that being used? Is that an area where we could perhaps provide time for a lab? Is it time for all kinds of things I can think of that would go into that time? I've already spent that time 12 ways. But that's what I worry about too. Like, I think we need to be really thoughtful about that and what that looks like for students, so.
You said something, and I'll speak for myself, and I'm sure my colleagues, I think, will back me up on this, where you said the teachers worry about the score and worry about the test score. And I think as a district, as a committee, as an administrative team, that has never been our primary focus, right? Our primary focus has been on growth and achievement,
right,
and what's best for kids. It is a data point that we use,
right,
but I don't think we have ever been that team that is focused on that and made decisions solely based on a score.
And I think intellectually, people know that. Yeah. People know that intellectually, but it's a number that gets attached to you and your work, right?
Sure.
So it's hard to not feel ownership of that. And the teachers do feel ownership of it because they want to provide the best opportunities for kids. And if that's not going in the direction that they like, they get frustrated too. They want to make sure that they're doing the right thing. So
I think if you're not looking at some of the scores, though, you run the risk of moving everyone to the middle. And that's always my concern, is that we need to make sure that the kids who have potential to get 4s and 5s get the instruction to get the 4s and 5s, and that may be using that for...
So the AP potential says it talks about a qualifying score out of 3. So
three or whatever,
the AP potential can't guarantee us the 4s and 5s, right? I mean, to me, that's a mix. That's instruction. It's curriculum. It's you intrinsically, what you value. It's what your family values. I mean, there's a whole host of things that go into that. So I agree that we don't want to let the students at the top not get pushed. They need to get pushed. But I think most teachers are able to do that.
And I would say, I mean, that was my biggest criticism, I think, last year. I think there's been a significant improvement in that particular area. And overall in the AP scores, I think there's been significant improvements in some of the scores and the participation and everything else. So I was very pleased with seeing that, and also with the recommendations. I think this is exactly what I was expecting to see for today's meeting, in terms of really giving it some thought about what needed to happen for this coming up year.
Did you get that in the minutes? Exactly what I was hoping to say.
Because I think, in the past, probably with prior administrations, we would have this conversation in December, and we would lose a whole year before something happened. And then we would talk about it and think about it and maybe do it for the next year.
And stuff that I don't even put up there, but like the teachers get individualized reports. They pour over those.
Right.
They look for the areas where, changes, is it multiple choice? Is it open response? Is it 5 choices, 4 choice? Like, they look at all that stuff pretty.
So they get actually information about take math's probably the easiest one. Are those questions grouped into subjects? And they can say,
yes,
it seems like
they're strands. Yes.
My kids seem to have missed.
Yep. They can do it by topic, Paul.
By topic, so hey, this is probably an area we need to rethink.
Yeah, and I'm not as well-versed in the math, but I know, like, for example, in the history, it's like, you know, pre-1850, post-1850, westward expansion, like, all those.
You can tell where.
Yeah.
So for this, can we put on the future agenda items a December update? Because a lot of these, that would be, there's what, two for the fall, one for the winter, and two for next summer. But at least if we could get updates on the top three.
Sure, whether or not the people are going to the training and stuff.
Yeah, let's talk about this in December, because I'll also talk about the planning for the...
That's the achievement report that last year, I think, I put you in a coma over. So worked very hard to make that more succinct for you, so that you don't go into a coma by the end of the night. But it will look similar to this. I'll do a cover, because all that PARC data and MCAS data...
Yep.
SAT, I mean, it's all there. DART.
I love the DART one, so they're my favorite.
I really appreciated the five-year trend, because we have these conversations every year and we're looking at snapshots. So this was like a really good comprehensive look of where we were, where we've been, where we need to go.
Right.
Great. Anything else on this?
Nope.
Good job.
Thank you for your support.
Thank you
very much.
So moving on to the consideration of first read recode of Series 2 and Series 6 policies, which is 2.6, 2.7, 2.9, 6.2, and 6.3.
Move to recode policies as presented.
Second.
So motion by Paul, second by Patrick. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? That is unanimous.
So this is just, just a housekeeping thing. You did a lot of this work a couple years ago, which is going to get reflected in your online manual. So as we continue to work through, I think Series 5 is the big one that's next.
Oh, yeah.
We started working on that, and we'll come back to you with that list. Some of the work has been done, and some of it's just kind of housekeeping pieces.
We did a lot of policy work.
Okay. So at 9:41, I'll take a motion to go into executive session pursuant to Chapter 30A, Section 21A3, to discuss strategy for negotiations, a personal services contract in a legal matter, as an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the legal position of the school committee as declared by the chair.
So moved.
So motion by Patrick.
Second.
Second by Suzanne. Patrick?
Yes.
Suzanne?
Some of them, but you have psychology. No, I don't think so.
Yeah.
I don't
know. No, I know, but do we want us to move to another room? I think I have a lot of work there. Do we want my room to move?
Yeah, it's not so hard.
Hi there.
Let's do that.
I had a suggestion before this.
I know, I'm talking.
You're actually like, I can make it.
And I just forgot my readers also. Awesome.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll leave your readers on there. If I'm gonna need them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great meeting.
Someone forgot their glasses, is that you?
Not, you don't have a passport, and they couldn't have my passport, it's not like I don't fly the damn airline. It's not like I haven't flown the damn airline to Canada either.
We're more fun than the selectmen, guys.
Oh, yeah.
Good question, Patrick.
But less fun than the Board of Health.
Exactly.
Although, want to be less fun than the Board of Health. Although, in case anybody's wanted to get the camera, I'm gonna whack Patrick. No.
No.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Yep.
See you later.
See you guys later.
Thank you.
We can't let everybody join in the fun.
Oh, no, this is, seriously, this is very interesting.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, we covered a lot of good stuff tonight.
You did, actually.
See, there is a board that gets the people's work done.
Yep. You guys did a splendid job.
Thanks, guys. I'll get back to you on that.